That while the criteria for statehood are necessary, this need not be permanent. That is, the temporary loss of one or more criteria does not lead to the extinction of the state. Your Excellency, the rationale for this is important. It is that states are important actors in international
law. Sir, you did not violate the criteria provided in the part of the Convention
on
the Rights and Duties of the State.
Indeed, Your Excellency. However, it does not violate the criteria of Article 1. But under Article 31, paragraph 3, clause B of the Vienna Convention of the Law of Nations, it notes that subsequent practice of states regarding the interpretation of the treaty must inform the analysis of the court. Please remember the subsequent practice of states notes clearly that the temporary loss of one or more criteria does not extinguish the state. For instance, in the case of Iceland, when in 1875, the population of Iceland migrated to Canada as a result of a volcanic eruption, that is an environmental reason. They formed a provisional government within Canada. However, for those 20 years when these people were forming a provisional government within Canada, Iceland was not extinguished. When they returned 20 years.
Subsequent practice of the state. What is the subsequent practice of the state, whether it is a treaty regime or a customary regime?
Yes, we submit Article 1 of the
Montreal Convention. What is a treaty regime or a customary regime?
Yes, Article 1 codifies customary international law. And Professor
Crawford
is
very clear. My question is very simple. According to you, your submission before us, Montreal Convention signifies treaty regime or customary regime.
The Montreal Convention is a treaty, Your Excellency. Simply accept. However, Article 1 also codifies customary
regimes. Are there members
to
the
Part 3
Convention?
No, Your Excellency.
Are there respondents of members to the Part 3
Convention? Yes, Your Excellency. The company notes this in paragraph 54.
So, the Part 3 Convention, since you are not a party to the TT, Part 3 of TT, how you are taking advantage of Part 3 of TT to the
Parliament? Your Excellency, under Article 38, paragraph 1B of the statute of this court, customary law is source of international law.
Yes, we are dealing with treaty law.
Yes, Your Excellency.
My question is very simple. When you submit before us that this is alleged a treaty law, are you a member to that, are you a party to that treaty?
No, Your Excellency.
Then what connection you are submitting before us, quoting the treaty to your advantage?
Your Excellency, Professor Baxter, in his lecture to the treaty, is a member.
Apart from stating authorities, authorities or opinion do this. Is there any decision of this court to establish that a state which lacks a territory can still be a state?
No, Your Excellency.
Is there any authority for any other international bodies?
Yes, Your Excellency. In the General Assembly, when the question of loss of territory and therefore the possible loss of state to state was raised in the 63rd session of the General Assembly, many Pacific Island states, which are on the brink of submergence in Alpha and Alpha, noted expressly that their state would be preserved. For instance, the Republic of the Marshall Islands noted on 27th September 2008, and I quote, that on the submergence of its territory, it would be permitted to retain its international personality. This state.
Then, what is the ruling in Island of Bahamas after national case?
Yes.
Which was clearly stated that territory is a necessary must for controlling statehood.
Yes, Your Excellency. The Island of Bahamas refers to a situation where there is territorial, what constitutes territorial sovereignty over there. In this case, we submit that Alcona does have territorial sovereignty over Nasatima Island, which it acquired on 9 March 2010. If I may refer Your Excellency to paragraph 45 to the contrary.
We
apply
from the Nasatima Island for the state.
Yes, Your Excellency.
Yes, Your Excellency. It is not a lease that.
Yes, Your Excellency.
How can you claim ownership over the lease that? It's a claim that you are the provision of the lease agreement to that.
Okay.
And what are the rights which you have part of the Nasatima Island?
Yes, Your Excellency. If I may address your question, paragraph 45 of the company clearly notes that Alcona has complete control over Nasatima Island. This control includes many things. For instance, clarification 4 to the company states that Alcona may enact and apply its own laws on Nasatima Island. The people of Nasatima Island are under the protection of the Alcoran government, and these people have no claim to the citizenship of Primo Tavu or to the protection justice laws. We submit that this constitutes effective control by Alpana and Nazarena, and this effective control.
You are using two terms interchangeably. Complete control is different from effective control. Which one has to be?
Yes, we submit that this complete control in this case.
But who is having effective control then?
Forgive me, Your Excellency.
Who is having effective control?
We submit that Alpana has effective control over the
debt. But who is having complete control?
Alpana.
It cannot be.
This requires.
You cannot enter both. When do I see the jurisprudence answer this question?
Yes,
who is having a 50 control, who is having overall control or absolute control? Complete control, pardon.
Your Excellency, your question of overall effect is.
No, we are clarifying it, not question. We are seeking clarification.
Yes, Your Excellency. This relates to the application of international responsibility in cases, for instance, cited in the Nicaraguan decision. However, what we are referring to in this case is complete control or effective control over the island.
Are you using it interchangeably? That's my question.
Yes, yes.
What is authority for that?
Yes.
What is authority for that? That they can be used interchangeably.
Your Excellency, our submission is that in the island of Kama's decision, which concerns territorial sovereignty over the island.
Yes. Territory is different from territorial sovereignty.
Yes, yes.
Is that clear? In this island, who will exercise territorial sovereignty?
We submit that Alcona exercises territorial sovereignty.
So if we have to fly that to fly over your territory, from whom they have to get permission?
Your Excellency,
from you or from the difference from the respondent?
Your Excellency, we submitted in this case.
Their sovereignty rests with whom? Suppose it is a water surrounded place either. Then the territorial waters belongs to whom?
Your Excellency,
has
Professor
Crawford
clearly,
Professor Brownlee. Professor Crawford,
the old doctor. Tell us about the facts, relies on the facts.
So territory is there, who will enjoy the external sovereignty? I'll focus my question. Who will exercise external sovereignty?
Your
Excellency. You are confusing between internal sovereignty and external sovereignty. So internal sovereignty may be with you. Who will exercise the external sovereignty and who will have effective control territorial sovereignty rests with you? These are the three questions and should be clarified for you.
On the first question of who has external sovereignty over the territory, we submit that Alcona has the external sovereignty.
From the facts, then?
Yes, Excellency.
Defense is with them?
Yes, yes.
Defense is not with you. Customs is not with you. Immigration is not with you. These are the constituent elements for signifying external sovereignty.
Yes, Excellency, we submit what is necessary to statehood is to test which entity has effective control.
We are not dealing with statehood, we are dealing with territory and territorial sovereignty. Am I right? So if you answer to pertaining to that aspect, territory and territorial sovereignty, not with statehood. Then we come to statehood. Once we establish whether it's territory or territorial sovereignty, then we will revert back to our Mazayan case and we will revert back to statehood. First, some basics are there, we'll clarify the basis. So who is having territorial sovereignty? That control is effective control or overall control? That is the question. You are not understood my question.
Your Excellency, the effective or overall control are tested or applied by the International Court of Justice. In the case of attributes of international responsibility,
yes, rights and duties. The statehood is attributed, that territorial sovereignty is an outcome of rights and duties, obligations of international, which is essential and a fourth essential condition and what media convention.
Your Excellency, our submission is that this complete control concerns the extent of the rights that Alcona can exercise over Nazarena. These include, for instance, police powers, legislative and executive duties.
These are all significance of internal sovereignty. We are talking about external sovereignty, defense, customs, immigration.
Your Excellency, if I may refer Your Excellency to instances in international law where these very powers are belonging to other states. For instance, the state.
Territorial sovereignty and territory. We are sticking to that. Don't try to debate our attention.
Yes, Your
Excellency. So the first one is who is having effective. You can go to the next issue, the next argument, second line, second question.
Which is the territorial sovereignty? Your Excellency, our submission in this case is that
Alcona
has territorial sovereignty for the following reasons.
Suppose there is some kind of oil inside, buried inside, deep inside. Who will have sovereignty over that oil? Some diamond fields are there, mines are there, oil mines are there. Who will exercise control over that sovereignty? I mean, permanent sovereignty over natural resources. under Act General Assembly Resolution 1893 of 1962. So it is ownership or sovereignty. I am specifically posing this question. I was post class this question. It is ownership or sovereignty.
For the purposes of
ownership or control.
What is important is that there is sovereignty but not ownership. This point is specifically addressed by Professor Crawford book on the creation of state. There he states.
When it is, which year it was done? Crawford book.
2006, the second edition.
So what is the relevance of it?
Your Excellency, it is a
subsidiary
source of international law.
Subsidiary source. We have customary law, we have guinea law, in absence of those things only we have to go for Crawford. So speaking to the customary practice and also treaty practice, because Montevideo Convention is you submitted before us, it is a treaty practice, you stick to that and then in the absence of that you can go to Crawford.
Yes, Your Excellency.
Speaking to
state practice relating to leases, where territorial sovereignty has been considered to have changed hands. For instance, between China and Germany. That lease is extremely similar to the lease in this case. For instance, under Article 3 of that lease, Germany possessed, and I quote, complete control over the Bay of Kiaocha. All the people in the Bay of Kiaocha were under the protection of the German government, but China retained the powers to exercise defense in that territory. When a dispute arose as to the status of this territory in 1914, many states, including China and Germany, as well as ministers of the United States, the United Kingdom, and the Netherlands, and several other states agreed that China had, and I quote, acquired under the lease sovereignty over the Bay of Kiaocha. We submitted this
practice. So, when it was that?
This was 1898.
One video convention came in 1933.
Yes, sir.
Please understand that. Chronological order. So, this 1902 case will not help you.
If I may
clarify. State practice has subject to Article 38, subclause 1, 2 of the whatever you have submitted before us, the state practice has changed.
If I may refer Your Excellency to one small point. It is that the practice of these territorial leases ended around the early 1900s. Your Excellency's question as to subsequent state practice is.
What is the subsequent state practice? That is what I was asking. Subsequent to Montevideo Convention.
Your Excellency's Montevideo Convention under Article 1 codified the customary practice of states relating to states. As such, the practice of states prior to the Montevideo Convention is also instructive in determining what the customary nature of this lease is in international law.
How treaty in Paris material is interpreted under international law? Treaties of same subject matter, how they are interpreted under Vienna Convention law treaties. Because you say it is a customary law codified in treaty, subsequent state practice, etc., etc. How treaties of Paris material, same substance, same subject matter is interpreted in under
international law. Your Excellency, treaties
in Paris material are interpreted in order to harmoniously consistent. That is a domestic law. What is international law? What is the provision in Vienna Convention law treaties?
If I may have a moment. Even though there is a heritage of a state, status of migrants in rotation territory. The only question is, in 2009, when it arrived in rotation territory, what obligation did the respondent have to grant these migrants status and rights under international law? We submit that there is a right under customary international law for these migrants to be granted complementary protection status. Yes.
What do you mean by the concept of state in exile under the international
law? Your Excellency, the question of what constitutes a state of government in exile under international law is a situation.
No, the question of government in exile or state in exile, are both these concepts same?
No, Your
Excellency. What
do you mean?
Which one is more applicable to the facts of this case?
Your Excellency, we submit that what may be more applicable to the facts of this case may be that of state in exile. That is situations where the territory and population and government of the state have completely shifted away to another territory. However, we submit that in this case, when these migrants left Indian capital on that day, that is, left the territory of that island and arrived in Indian territory, the respondent had an obligation under customary international law to grant these migrants status and rights under what is known today as complementary or subsidiary protection. This protection is granted to persons who are fleeing. If I may have complete message. Such protection is granted to persons who are fleeing territories where there is a threat to their life of freedom, or circumstances that is not within their control. These affluent migrants clearly are fleeing territories where there is a severe threat to their life of freedom because of the submergence of these islands. We submit that under customary international law, there exists an obligation on the respondent to provide these rights. In order to establish this right under customary international law, under Article 38, paragraph 1b of the statute in this court, this one requires that custom be proved by consistent and widespread state practice, accompanied by a belief that this practice is obligatory as a matter of law, that is, a belief opinion. We submit that both of these are satisfied in this case. For instance, on the question of state practice, several resolutions of the General Assembly, the resolutions 1127, 3802, and 5217.
No, whether resolutions were never assembled, can it be enforced through this court?
Your Excellency.
What is the legal status of resolutions of never assembled?
Your Excellency, resolutions of the General Assembly constitute state practice under Article 3810.
Very wide imagination.
Your Excellency, this court in
West Africa case. Subsequent General Assembly resolution in the same subject may be evidence of customary law, that is not observation. It is a customary law. Southwest Africa case, Justice Tanaka said, General Assembly resolutions in the same subject may be evidence of customary law. It has been supported by Rosalie Williams also. Never they said, General Assembly resolution is a customary
law. A limited submission is that General Assembly resolutions are not evidence of state practice because they are
evidence of state practice or opinion views?
Evidence of state practice, Your Excellency, is in this
case. What is the difference between opinion views and evidence of state practice? Evidence of custom. What is the difference between evidence of custom and evidence of state practice?
Your Excellency, we submit that state practice is constituted by acts of state when.
What is firstly necessary, opinion views or state practice? State practice procedures by opinion of juris and state practice.
Your Excellency, customary law requires that there be state practice along with opinion of juris, Your Excellency.
Which one is first? Opinion of juris or state practice?
Your Excellency,
read to many of the judgments of this case.
Immediately.
Social jurisdiction case, opinion of law case, everything. Tell us, which is first? Opinion of juris or state practice?
Your Excellency, this court.
Opinion of juris followed by state practice, or state practice followed by opinion of juris?
Your Excellency, this court. The 1969 decision of Nazi Continental Shell and the paragraph of page 48 that there must be state practice accompanied by opinion.
That's we are clear about it. So which one should be first? State practice, opinion of juris, followed by state practice or what?
Your Excellency, in most circumstances, there is state practice. So state practice which comes first, followed by.
In the elements, there are only physical elements. Am I right?
Your Excellency, this question.
Possession also. Animus person, cannot be corpus person. So state practice, physics, or which is first? State practice or opinion?
Your Excellency, this chicken and egg question,
I'm not going. I'm restricting myself to the jurisprudence of ICT.
Yes,
I am not the Anaconda in which case, but stay in our chicken. What is the jurisprudence of ICJ regarding this aspect? Subsequent cases.
Your Excellency, in subsequent cases, in subsequent cases of the international court of justice, such as the Indian Accord decision or in the recent Congo versus Uganda decision, this court is considered the same practice of the
company
by
opinion.
There is no decision.
Which should be first? Trade practice or not?
Your Excellency, there is no explanation by this court as to
which. The explanation is that the resolution or evidence of opinion juries, if they are accepted in that case, the practice like judicial opinion or any. Then state practice.
However, Professor Tignor is also noted in his 1958 article in the British Code of International Law that general assembly resolutions, because they are voted on by states, also constitute practice by states, that is, their position on the issues that they are voting on. Please remember that this applies in this case. For instance, in the general assembly resolutions in 1122 of 2802, states have unanimously agreed that persons.
What is the difference between general assembly declaration and general assembly resolution?
Yes.
Is there any legal significance in
that?
Yes. The General Assembly resolution passed without voting, unanimously passed. The General Assembly resolution passed with voting, some members opposing it, some member abstaining it, etc. And the General Assembly resolution termed as declaration. Is there any difference with reference to assembly international?
Your Excellency, if I may have a moment. Your Excellency, if there is a general that is passed with a voting passed unanimously, that constitutes clear evidence, as noted by Professor Tignor is available, of state practice, unanimous state practice in that area.
Which more is opinion is pre-UN period. Thank you. We have subsequent decision.
Thank you. If I may also
go to. So, reverting back to your earlier thing, you said the state, what is the status of these people who have crossed borders? Whether they are refugees under refugee convention, or migrants, or workers, whatever, what is the name international could be, under international could be accorded to? What is the status of these persons who have crossed borders?
Your Excellency, please submit to the respondent an obligation to write complementary protection status.
Complementary protection status, vis-a-vis to whom? What is the status as refugees, or migrants, or environment migrants, eco migrants, whatever, what is the status?
Complementary protection status is a special status in international law.
Some status has to be given and they should be called as some people, isn't it?
Yes.
Same complementary protection, accord second status to them. What is the status?
Your Excellency, we submit that these migrants may be called migrants. However, the complementary protection status.
Without any prefix or without any adjective, simply migrants.
Your Excellency, as Professor
Hathaway
notes in
his
article on what is a label. The term refugee or migrant is
used. Professor Hathaway was much concerned about internally displaced persons and economically displaced persons. Is that clear? So that will not help your case.
I am sure that's sufficient.
Yes.
Our limited submission in this case is that the people in
Indonesia
are entitled to complementary protection status.
This international recognized environmentally displaced persons, environmental migrants,
yes,
under complementary jurisprudence, complementary protection jurisprudence.
Your Excellency, under the complementary protection jurisprudence, if I may cite the legislations of three states, for instance.
Yeah, my question was very simple. Whether environmental or eco refugees are recognized under complementary jurisprudence. Complementary protection jurisprudence.
Yes, Your Excellency. For this, we rely on state practice, such as the immigration legislation in the United States, Sweden, and Finland, where under the terms of these legislations, people flee environmental or climate disasters are recorded specific protection.
Yes, yeah, state practice or general principles recognized by civilized legislations.
Your Excellency, we submit that these legislations constitute.
Are municipal, actually. They are all municipal law. Whether they are state practice or third category, paragraph C, general principles recognized by civilized nations.
Your Excellency, they are state practice. Because under Article 38.1 clause B,
general principles are recognized by civilized nations. Does it constitute state practice?
No, Your Excellency. General principles of law recognized by civilized nations. For instance, the principle.
Can you tell us the hierarchy of norms specified in Article 36 of the Statute of
Your Excellency, Article 38.1 prescribes four sources. Secondly, international custom as evidence of fact is generally recognized as law. Third, the general principles of law recognized by civilized nations. And fourth,
which you say that it is state rights.
No, Your Excellency. We submit that municipal legislation constitutes state rights. This is, however, general principles of law, such as that of abusive rights.
Now, in the absence of a specific judgment earlier passed by this court, clearly governing this case, do you suggest that principles of good and right and good can be applied in this case?
Yes.
Principles of right and good. Justice and equity. Does it have any application in determining the rights of me?
Yes.
To be participating in this case? Yes,
it is a two-pronged response.
What is the principle of right and good in international law?
Your Excellency, two responses. First, under Article 38, paragraph 2 of the statute of this court may decide on equity if both parties agree that this court may decide. However, principles of equity, such as that of the inherent power of jurisdiction of the court, may be applied by this court under Article 38(1), paragraph C of the statute of this court, which constitutes general principles of law recognized by civilized nations, for instance. Therefore, we submit that
is this court bound by an earlier decision of this court?
No, Your Excellency. Under Article 59 of the statute of this court, decisions are indeed, Your Excellency, under Article 38(1), paragraph B of the statute of this court, that previous judicial decisions form subsidiary sources of international law for this court, Your Excellency. We submit, therefore, that these migrants who are in education territory are entitled to complementary protection status and uniform rights as are afforded to refugees under international law. This is because.
So they are afforded diplomatic protection?
Indeed, Your Excellency, they can. And this is our second.
So that is the right. So if you have diplomatic protection, then complementary protection in Kashmir will not be applicable. Because in the absence of exercise of diplomatic protection and minimum standard of treatment of aliens, there will be complementary protection jurisprudence.
Yes.
In the absence of these two internationally recognized regimes, then the third is you. It is not all of them, you cannot exercise all of them. That is incorrect.
First, on the question of diplomatic protection. This court is not wrong in recognizing that what is necessary.
Yeah, not considerable. So you say they can exercise diplomatic protection. My question is, when you are entertaining diplomatic protection, whether complementary protection rules should come in or not?
Yes
or no?
Yes, Your Excellency.
Give me the authority. The writing, only one author has written about this complementary jurisprudence. Nowhere they have cited this. We have an authority, you hear, otherwise, don't waste it.
They said, along with
minimum treatment of alien, diplomatic protection, complementary protection, which words can be accepted to the Indian authority, at least to the time is up, you can go on to the.
Yes, sir. If I
may
only cite Professor
Neil Shankar. Yes, sir. Which page, which paragraph, which line, we need not even give you the authority. You can just say, page number this, paragraph this. That's it. We have this. You want to take some time? A moment?
Yes, sir. Your Excellency, Professor Neeraj Nathani, who was also a legal advisor to the United
States. We are not concerned about that decision.
Yes, sir.
What is given in the paragraph, tell me. Don't waste our time. Don't go on repeating the question. Question is very simple. Give me the paragraph, give me the line. We don't want to change. I consider all your only one authority is there. I consider the point. Where that authority is given, what is authority given to me? What is the opinion given by the
Your Excellency, in this article, in the Life and General of International Law, he notes expressly that states that even.
Which page? Which paragraph? That's what I'm concerned.
The entire article concerns this issue, Your Excellency. Whether the state which has.
I think you are arguing over ICJ without any material. Yes. If there are the ideas, we need to have the specific paragraph, we need to know the specific wordings, specific lines.
Your Excellency, I
am
unable to quote
that. Then move on. That's what I asked. Whether you are able to quote or not, you can move on to the next paragraph. But time is up, my friend.
Your Excellency, can I summarize the final submission to the new one? Our final submission is that the respondent that arbitrarily detaining them in the Moroma Election Center has also violated Article 9 of the Civil. Of the covenant for civil and political life. This is for two reasons. First, the purpose of their detention is invalid, and secondly, the actions that they have taken in detaining these migrants for 2 years at the Moroma Center are two branches correspond purpose, whether it is arbitrary purpose. The United Nations High Commissioner acknowledges that immigration detention is a valid purpose. However, when this detention is for a prolonged or indefinite period, this will become...
The security regime will not be applicable. Complimentary jurisprudence, complimentary protection jurisprudence, you have any authority, you are. You can't mix both.
The Excellency, the United Nations High Commissioner of Refugees has a larger mandate than that is covered by...
What is the legal status of a report given by the United Nations High Commissioner?
The Excellency...
What is the legal status of a report given by the United Nations High Commissioner in international law?
The Excellency is an authoritative under Article 38.1b of the Statute of Corpus.
Primary source or secondary source?
Subsidiary source, brother.
Yes,
I put it that way, subsidiary source.
Yes.
Not primary or secondary, subsidiary source of the brother.
Yes, sir. We submitted in this case, this prolonged and indefinite detention of these migrants is invalid. For instance, the Human Rights Committee has noted in C.Jessup Australia that a detention of over 3 years is considered arbitrary.
They have a right to assent.
No.
But then these migrants have a right to assent.
Your Excellency, they have a right to seek asylum under international law.
What is the difference between right to asylum and right to seek
asylum? Your Excellency, the right to asylum would imply obligation on the respondent of the receiving state to grant asylum. We agree that that does not exist in international law.
Why? What is the difference between when right to seek asylum is arranged? What is the obligation of the other party when you exercise right to seek asylum? And what is the obligation of the other party when you exercise right to asylum?
Your Excellency, when an individual exercises the right to seek asylum, under, for instance, the 1951 Convention for the
Right. You said it is not applicable to question.
Under customary international law, the respondent.
What is the customary international law?
That is a complementary or subsidiary protection.
You have not established before us that it is a customary international law. Only one authority is for the purpose. There is no state by it. Which country has accorded complementary jurisprudence to India, the migrant worker, economic worker, eco, migrant, whatever, eco, refugees, etc. One state practice.
Your Excellency, if I may cite the example of New Zealand, or Sweden and Finland, both, all three of which...
Is it furtherance of judicial pronouncement or is it furtherance of legislation?
It is a legislation, Your Excellency, under both acts. However, also decisions of the European Union, directives of the European Union under the 2004 Subsidiary Protection Directive bind the members of the European Union to afford subsidiary protection status, which is similar to complementary protection status under international law. We submit that this also constitutes evidence of state practice. If I
what is the international law principle of protection of state plus persons?
Indeed, yes.
What are the supporting documents to substantiate this right?
Yes. Yes, you see, there are two conventions under international law. The first concerns the convention. Your Excellency, the first concerns the status of stateless persons, which is a 1954 convention. And the second concerns the convention for the reduction or elimination of statelessness in 1961.
You don't want introductions. Answer to the specific question. What my brother did
know.
Yeah, we don't want to know what is the stateless person, we don't want to know which PTBS is, whatever it is. Answer to this specific question. Yeah, answer, you answer, otherwise you can't debate the question.
These conventions came into existence for two reasons. First, because there were many instances during the Nazi era when people were made stateless by their states. And secondly, because individuals have a right to nationality under international law under Article 15 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. These statelessness conventions thus explain that people cannot be made stateless, or that if people are already stateless, measures must be taken by the state on which they are resident in order to naturalize them and to grant them nationality in pursuance of their right to nationality under international law. We submit in any case that these migrants are already as per the national.
What is the difference between deportation and expulsion and expulsion? Deportation and expulsion are the principle of non-refugal movement. Non-refugal
principle. Your Excellency, expulsion is in situations where, for instance, an individual does not qualify for the status of a refugee under the 1951 Refugee Convention. In those situations, a state may
other situation.
Before
the issue which country of child India has to be sent to the country of origin, expulsion means just he will expulse from the country.
Can you summarize my point?
Thank you.
Thank you.
That if an individual is in a territory where his life is being threatened, the state tells him that he is moved out. If the individual chooses to stay in that territory, his wish must be expected. For example, in the Iraq Kuwait when Iraq invaded Kuwait, several Kuwaiti citizens.
Is it a customary law or an operation of international law?
Customary international law under.
Are there any other party followed?
Your Excellency, the human
is an exception to general rule, or is it a rule itself? I thought it was very simple.
It is a rule.
But,
it is a rule itself.
Whether it has been repeated any
if I offer three instances of state practice. First, in the 1960s and 70s, when several migrants were fleeing from Cambodia during the Pol Pot regime, Thailand and Malaysia, several individuals chose to stay there. That is possible. Second, Your Excellency, this is the case of the Srebrenica massacre in Iraq.
There was no threat to life.
Your Excellency,
when there is a threat to life, what is the duty of the state exercising diplomatic protection? Whether they should allow you to stay there and die, or whether they should exercise various international obligations under various rules?
It should exercise best efforts to move. It is an obligation of conduct, not one of reason. Now, Your Excellency, if I address the board on the issue I was addressing, on the
second issue.
The second issue, Your Excellency, the second issue of the transfer.
No, the second limb of this argument.
Second limb. Now, Your Excellency, the respondent state seeks to transfer these migrants to the state of Siam. We submit this transfer violates international law. And again, I will refer the court to the relevant law and then the facts. The relevant law is the duty of non-refoulement or the duty of non-refoulement. For example, several courts, and I will offer the support of breadth of state practice. For example, the El Taim decision of the Israel Supreme Court, the landmark Sorim decision of the European Court of Human Rights, and several other
courts.
Sorim, for instance. Sorim was United Kingdom. It was the first case of the European Court of Human Rights.
Chair.
I believe it was in the early 90s, Your Excellencies. I will offer a more recent case to the 2011 decision in LSS versus Belgium.
How are both the decisions as far as we are concerned? Can I say about how many decisions of the European Court?
Absolutely not, Your Excellencies. This court is not bound by those decisions. However, such instances of state practice, as Ms. Maria reported, are relevant as evidence of customary international. If I may address what those decisions say.
Honestly, your decision has to state practice. There must be a opinion to this. The state must believe firmly that I should act in a given situation in this particular fashion. Not simply following certain principles, it will not amount to customary law.
Absolutely.
You should believe, the mental element must be there, that I should behave in this particular fashion. That is what opinion to this is all.
Absolutely. If I may offer express practice where opinion units was also reflected by state.
First opinion units must be there. I should act in a particular situation, I should act in this particular fashion.
For example, Your Excellency, I will show where opinion units was present. In Agiza versus Sweden, for example, an individual Mr. Agiza was transferred by Sweden to Egypt.
In that individual cases, there is a state practice.
Your Excellency, state practice was when, for example, legally transferred 1,000 migrants from.
So there must be an international observation, this is our feeling and we are following it.
Indeed.
That should be that. So our first where is a statement issued, any note, any diplomatic statement, any general assembly statement, any general assembly resolution, any exchange of notes, joint community, etc. Then you have followed this in your state practice, then it is opinion juris, coupled with state practice, amounting to
as customary law. As Mr. President noted, I will first provide general assembly resolutions. Then I will provide protest of states and Mr. President request. General Assembly Resolution 44162 and
47133
recognize. These resolutions are also referred to the memorial if I may point your attention to that page.
Wrongly quoted, I believe.
In page 27 of our reservations, that paragraph 63 says several decisions on this of various courts and instruct factors. Now, residencies on the specific point of outside decisions on courts, I will offer an example to explain an instance where state practice happened and this principle was applied. In 2007, in residencies, we may not have referred to it in that case, however, we have referred to decisions of various courts. We have referred, however, to the Australian Pacific solution to which I have asked. When a customary norm is developed, if a state from the beginning objects to that customary norm, that custom does not apply to that state, that is persistent objective. For example, if your
excellency
is addressing the specific solution of the state practice instance. From 2005 to 2007, Australia signed an agreement with Malaysia. Stating that
so one has to unwanted issues that are
Your Excellency, this is the limb of whether the proposed transfer is valid. Shall I address the fourth issue? Or shall I address this issue? Your Excellency,
so it's clear of time. Can I address the third limb of this first issue?
Indeed.
Third issue, and then we will move on to the fourth issue.
I shall briefly summarize the submission and then move on to the fourth issue. If I may draw the court's attention to clarification 10 to the conclusion. Now, clarification 10 is a statement by the Human Rights Committee and various individuals, which has been accepted by SIDA, where the conditions of detention in camps sought out, the facility where the alcohol migrants will also be housed in days. Individuals there are subject to sexual abuse, malnutrition, and various other issues. The question before this court is there a real risk that the alcohol migrants will also be subject to such injury? Now, Your Excellency, briefly summarize since my time is short, please submit there is a real risk. That real risk exists for two reasons. In similar questions, the Committee Against Torture, which is the specialized body for such matters, has noted that courts must consider how similarly situated individuals have been treated in the court state. In this case, detainees at Camp Sarantar have been implicated, and they are similarly situated to the alcohol migrants, who will also then be transferred. Your Excellency, in fact, the facts in our case are similar to the facts in Javikin World
War. In this case, the respondent is shouldering all the responsibility.
Rabikin versus Russia was an exact case.
In this case, the respondent is shouldering all the financial responsibility, all other responsibilities. So that cannot help you. There is, you cannot be any other.
Your Excellency, if I may narrate the facts in Rabikin versus Russia and then demonstrate how it will be an analogy. Or if the court is not convinced, I should cite Shamanem, the decision in Shamanem.
It's up to you. You will not cause any increased detriment, whether we are convinced or not. It's up to you, as the agent.
Your Excellency, the question to be briefed is this. As Special Rapporteur Novak to the Commission Against Torture noted in the second and fourth agenda section, when a state is transferring to a third state, which has been known to commit human rights violations, it must obtain from that third state an unequivocal guarantee, at least a guarantee that these rights will not be violated.
This case is very silent about that. That is covered about.
Your Excellency, it is not.
What is the fourth issue?
Absolutely. Your Excellency, the fourth issue concerns the seizure of the Alcohol Central Bank's account in the Bank of Land of the respondents. Your Excellency, in 1992, the applicant and respondent signed the Climate Change Loan Agreement.
And what is the nature of this loan agreement? Whether it is a contract or a treaty under international law?
It is a contract.
What is the difference between a contract and a treaty under international law?
The difference is noted in the Vienna Convention. A treaty is one is agreement between states which is governed by international law. In this case, the clarification is to the contrary clearly states that the agreement is governed by a rotation of the
clarification says no.
Yes.
What is the law? Except twice of law. Yes, the law is accepted.
Rotation. Your Excellency, this prevention.
Fourth bulletin, says?
Absolutely.
Twice of law.
Your Excellency, this, as I find in report, for example, Professor Adrian Page, the Nobel Authority.
No, no, we'll possibly do that.
Absolutely.
So, what is the feeling? What is
So meaning your excellency.
Provisions regarding choice of law, etc. What does it mean?
It means two things. It means that although rotation law applies, the concept of refers to private international law as Professor Adrian Green states.
Yes. Any contract in case, each way it's a contract, it's not an international contract. So, any one should law, why private international should
come? Excellency, private international.
Private international, when did it come? Between two individuals, not between two states.
Your Excellency, if I may address that question.
Then, for the reason whether it is a concession contract or a contract?
Your Excellency, there is no concession contract in this case. There is no concession.
Yes.
Which is why Your Excellency is finding any documents to address that question. Choice of law or private national, which are used interchangeably.
However, choice of law is different from choice of law in a contract.
Your
conflict of laws. What is what conflict of laws?
Yes. Why such agreements are included? It is to prevent the doctrine of non-nua from operating. The doctrine of non-nua is where.
So, what is the reason for it? What is the reason for choice of law pertaining to procedure law?
Your Excellency, is
the
when a dispute goes to an arbitral tribunal, which has
so it's to prevent forum shopping.
Any Your Excellency.
Right. So now we can go. Now the choice of law applicable to procedure law or substantive law. This provision, this the clarification.
Yes, this is a very substantial rotation law that applies. However, if I address the question in this case, well, that difference does not arise in the facts of this case. For example, I think a similar question came up before this court in the Norwegian law decision, where the court ultimately declined jurisdiction because the question was only a matter of interpretation of the contract and no question of international law. The question of international law here is twofold. The first is responsible sovereign lending principles, and the second is our reliance on the defense of necessity. Now, Your Excellency, if I may draw the board's attention.
You develop what
I want to say about the principle of bypass of the Sarvata as an approved principle in international law.
It is an approved principle, Your Excellency, but it has exceptions. One of them, the exceptions are the principles of responsible sovereign lending. If I may address that contention to which Your Excellency.
That is not the exception. What are the exceptions?
Your Excellency, there are several exceptions. The defense of necessity, force majeure, various other things noted in the articles of state responsibility, fraud, undue coercion, and several other defenses that are given. The one that we argue in this case is the principle of responsible sovereign.
What is the airport of the law for abuse quotas?
Indeed, Your Excellency, if a norm of use quotas or a peremptory norm of international law arises, no obligation may go against the norm of use quotas. That is well established in international law. As for example, if an agreement between two states to commit genocide is an illegal agreement, then it cannot be.
Right, Article 53 and 64 of the Fundamental Law of the British.
Absolutely.
Yes.
If I address.
You don't want a very discussion on that.
Absolutely.
Yes, any earlier, what is the position vis-a-vis, just what is vis-a-vis, Pactas and Sarvata?
Your Excellency, if the performance of the obligation under the Pactas and Sarvata rule violates a use for its obligation, then the use for this obligation will take precedence. For example, if I
want. The treaty itself becomes invalid.
Indeed, Your Excellency, the treaty will. However, in this case, because it is not a treaty, it cannot become invalid. If I may address the question.
So, Pactas and Sarvata will not be applicable to
the. It is applicable, Your Excellency.
Why? Because it is not a treaty.
Your Excellency, Pactas and Sarvata doesn't only apply to treaties. If I were to sign a contract with my learned friend, that would also be regulated by the.
That is what? That is your.
Your Excellency, this was precisely noted by this court of the Norwegian law decision in paragraph 2. If I may, Your Excellency, address the question either responsible sovereign lending or the defense of necessity.
So what is if we consider this as official development assistance? Development of development assistance.
Okay.
So what is the international emerging law regarding? You have any authority with that?
Absolutely.
You don't consider this as a law, consider this as an official development aid or package or whatever it is. Especially under UNFCCC.
Absolutely, Your Excellency.
Because you have not addressed the framework convention on climate change.
Absolutely.
Because that is pretty good. Any emerging jurisprudence in this regard?
There is an emerging jurisprudence, and that is precisely my
question.
When an official. When official development assistance is given to a small island state like California, there is an equal responsibility on the lender state to ensure that the funds reach their developmental goals. This, Your Excellency, is outside of four instances of state practice and the legal rationale.
A comparative play is if that is reached for development purposes. Let us not go into the rest of
the government.
Money has been transferred to the root of the risk, so let us not waste our time.
Absolutely.
So, Your Excellency, I will not be informative because we are deviating from the facts.
I will
not have facts or different.
I will address one submission. If I may draw the court's attention to the fourth paragraph of Annex A to the conformity, which is the loan agreement between the states, the fourth paragraph states that if one of the works under the agreement is worth more than $5 million, the applicant must contract with the company of the respondent states that. Now, in this case, one of the primary reasons or the purposes of the climate change loan agreement was to construct seaworks, which are physical barriers between the licensed sea levels and the applicant's level. In this case, to construct these seaworks, we contracted with MCA, who, as is clearly stated in clarification 1, was the only eligible Rotarian company. There was no other Rotarian company we could have referred. Now, in paragraph 20, it is clearly stated that. Indeed, Your Excellency, that is the very question which was addressed.
Immediately, of command order, so long as they possess the requisite qualifications.
Indeed, absolutely.
So, don't you are curating for the facts. So, you decided that they have possessed requisite experience and you are awarded. You can stop it.
Your Excellency,
stop it. You are spinning stories. As so long as they possess requisite experience, you can award. You could have rejected it. You thought that they possess required experience.
Your Excellency, two responses. The question here is of this. The alternate governor of the IMF, Professor Honor, notes that in such cases.
This will not come here because it is not an international treaty, it is only a law.
In your Excellency, if I cite an identical instance of state practice, which this won't
be. Identical instance, stop with that, don't say state practice.
Your Excellency, it is an identical instance where a similar example between states occurred, and if I may offer the conclusion that is reached.
But it was given in the occurrence of UNFCC?
Your Excellency, this
law. Then it cannot be another.
Your Excellency, if I may demonstrate that case and explain why it is still relevant.
Also, don't try to waste all. If it is given under UNFCC, then you are. Otherwise, you will be interested in some. Because there cannot be any similar
activity. But you said what are the international obligations that they do another state?
I apologize.
What are the legal consequences arising from an international obligation of the state to another state?
That question is answered by the afternoon statement responsibility. If a state violates an international obligation, then its responsibility is engaged vis-à-vis the state to which such obligation is owed. Now, Your Excellency, if I may briefly address this, I am already out of time. The question of necessity.
We need to be asked to answer. I'm asking about the international obligation. And also the obligation in respect of our international law. Legal consequences of an international law.
If a state has an international obligation to perform obligation X, and it does not perform obligation X, its international responsibility is engaged. The question of the consequences is either there must be full reparation or satisfaction or any other form of compensation which is provided in international law, which was known as the Rainbow Volume.
So, any other form of satisfaction or compensation? What
are the forms of
oppression? What are the forms of
the primary mode is of restitution or in integral, which is to say that you must fully reparate the state which has been wrong.
That is known as restitution.
Restitution in integral.
And which mode of oppression do you suggest in the facts of this case?
Your Excellency, in this case, all we ask is for a judgment where we are provided restitution. They have taken our funds, $25 million. We ask to be.
So you are coming here with
your offers to the ambulance when you do wrongs up and harassment, which is the only thing we are committed with that.
A declarative judgment is a judgment of satisfaction, which has been noted by the international operation, but the respondent takes it.
Satisfaction.
Your Excellency's satisfaction, which is a legal term of art, refers to a
satisfaction for satisfaction as against better harassment.
Your Excellency, we ask this court for a declarative judgment. The parties will subsequently enter
into the mode of oppression that can be granted as against boxer.
Your Excellency,
and harassment.
In several instances, a monetary award may be granted. However, the prayer in this case does not ask for that. In the compromise, they state,
what is the name of the principle of rehabilitation as a mode of oppression?
Indeed, Your Excellency, if the court finds that in this case there is a violation, the first obligation is on the respondent state is to seize that violation, which will mean that they must be rehabilitated in the respondent state's territory and not transferred to the state of site. That is a natural and necessary component of the declaration. Mr. President, if I have your permission, may I briefly address the question of necessity?
No, I will take one. See, necessity will come only if it is governed by international. You say it is not governed by international, it is governed only by municipal law, then the question does not arise. Why should I give you time for that?
there is moreover, I am interested to be referenced to DuPont. The critical name at this election, she is for its own account, any collateral or any other property of the data subject to its control without further notice and without need to for any judicial authorization of the amount of the then current projected. So if it is executed as a principal law, then you need not argue before, the question be argued before.
Two responses to that.
In case this situation. Then there is no international law, why should it be executed? It should go to, go to the municipal court. Come after exhaustion of local communities.
Mr. President, if I can address that question in two parts, I should be very brief with my time. The first is that the alleged violation of the international law on sovereign immunity, that is a question of international law.
You are waiving your sovereign immunity by this. That is the point I am raising. You are waiving your sovereign immunity. What is the difference between an act of state and sovereign immunity? What is the difference between an act of state and sovereign immunity?
We are expressing an act of state is where a state acts in sovereign capacity. We are expressing that.
But in sovereign immunity, the state doesn't act on its sovereign capacity.
We demonstrate sovereign immunity is where a state's assets.
Both relates to act of state only. What is the difference?
Your Excellency,
act of state and sovereign immunity.
Act of state is a doctrine.
You know the answer?
Yes, Your Excellency, yes. I say remark. Act of state is where a court in a municipal state will not judge the actions of another state because of
sovereign immunity also there. The court will not have exercised jurisdiction over the actions of the sovereign state.
Your Excellency, sovereign immunity is specifically applicable to cases of execution or jurisdiction. Act of state can be applicable outside that question.
Act of state relates to acts done by a state within its own jurisdiction. Sovereign immunity is everything. Other jurisdiction.
Yes.
That is the difference. So, talk about sovereign immunity. Whether you have waived your sovereign immunity by entering into this loan agreement, loan contract, now you are standing before us claiming sovereign immunity. How you are justified? Answer in one line and you can go to your way.
The sovereign immunity waiver in the climate change loan agreement is a general waiver which does not apply to central bank assets which must be specifically used. That is a submission and it's recognized in Article 21.1c of the UN.
So, from where was the fund was lying? Where the fund was lying?
In the central bank's account.
Is it an official organ of your state?
Your Excellency, it is Alphona state.
Any other argument, I'm giving you proof. Any other argument you have in furtherance of this? Because it is lying with the official organ of the state, whether still waiver of immunity is not applicable or applicable. I'm giving you a proof.
The authority,
you have another answer to this question.
The authority is Article 21.1c of the UN Convention.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President, Your Excellency. The applicant rests its submissions and maintains its parent rule subject to 3 minutes reserve for serving the party. Subject to Mr. President's decision.
Of course, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. President, Your Excellency, for the privilege.
My submission, Master. Your Excellencies, the first convention of the respondent state is that the applicant fails to fulfill the criteria of statehood as enumerated by international law, and consequently is very poor. These four factual issues are divided into five contentions.
Is there any significance for it?
No, yes.
What is it? Yes.
Can you clarify the last question?
The court is little furious about it. Is there any significance because you have presented six issues on the contrary to the compromise presented before us under Article 40 of ICJ statute?
The extent is only for the sake of simplification, happy presentation.
Simplification would have been 3A3, 3A3, 3B, like that. Not six issues.
Much of that, Excellency.
Do not deviate from the compromise.
Indeed, Excellency.
Because you have to put us based on an agreement. Do not deviate from the agreement.
Indeed, Excellency. Much of that. The Excellency, moving on to the first contention, prove that I will be showing that the applicant does not fulfill the criteria of statehood as enumerated by international law.
Yes, this court is called as ICJ or a World Court?
The International Court of Justice.
We have repeatedly reported as a World Court. What is the reason for it?
Yes, sir.
Why is it little curious?
The Excellency is in the ICJ.
Is it a parties of your ICJ? To call us World Court or ICJ?
The Excellency is since the ICJ.
Not a fixed court.
The Excellency is, as the Excellency stated, this ICJ will even be a fixed court for global disputes.
But it's not a state practice. So stick to the state practice. What is diplomatic? You say. Stick to that. You cannot use World Court.
Indeed, Excellency. The Excellency, as stating the Montenegro Convention on the Rights and Duties of States of 1933, which has been reflected, accepted as reflected in customary international law, as stated by Professor Judge Rosalind Higgins in a reply, sees the development of international law to the political organs of the United Nations, lays down four essential criteria for statecraft, legal personality, and international law. The essences, these are: number one, permanent population; number two, territory; number three, government; and number four, capacity to enter relations with other states. The essences are one by one show how these criteria are not met in international law. The essences, at the outset, I would like to cite the German Polish Nips Arbitral Tribunal in the Dosh Continental Gas case, which stated that in the non satisfaction of any one of these criteria, a state shall deem to not exist in international law.
So where do you want to address all the issues? When you say in the event of non satisfaction,
any one,
for example, territory, and say everything is gone.
Any Excellency.
Because you categorically stated footnote 5, I mean, what is footnote 5? In the event of non satisfaction of any one of the aforementioned criteria, it still shall not be deemed to exist in international law. And if you save the time of the court, if you prove there is no territory, and one of the essential conditions under one video convention is not fulfilled, then your argument is.
And I will go on to show how territory and permanent population is not.
First, you address territory.
My Excellency, at the outset, in the historical island of Palmas case, territory under international law is defined as an area over which an entity possesses the exclusive right to display an attribute of the state. Further, in that case, it was held that the critical loss of territory does not lead to an extension of the state, but complete loss does lead to the extension of the state. The Excellency, in the current case, since both the constant islands of the applicant, that is, but we are angry, as clearly stated in paragraph 25 and paragraph 44 of the compromise submerged underwater, there was a complete loss of
territory. Territory asked to be the city, natural territory or artificial territory?
The Excellency, territory as stated here means natural territory.
Now, suppose you say that a state is lacks natural territory but has artificial territory, lacks statehood. That is your connection.
The Excellency, if I may just draw your attention to Article 60 of the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, which states that such artificial territory does not have a territory of the sea, and therefore it would not classify under the definition of territory or even as a manufactured island. There is a practice among states to have artificial islands, but these would not constitute as territory when taking, say, territory of the sea, the distance by measuring the distance of territory of the sea or economic zone into account.
Now, what about the concern of green field, the particular green field? If it satisfies the other requirements of statehood, does it not continue to enjoy or assume to enjoy statehood?
Your Excellencies, as a state requires these four criteria. In the absence of one or more of them, it will cease to exist as a state. Though legal personality, as seen in certain instances, has continued, but as a very state, it would not continue. Your Excellencies, an example, in such instances, it would not exist as a state. What it would exist is a non-state actor in international, such as the sovereign order of Malta, which does not have territory and post losing territory, it is not being recognized as a state. But however, countries do consider it as a non-state actor in international law, which at max can only get observer status at international bodies.
Is there any concept like full state, half state, quarter state, state, non-state?
Your Excellencies, I will not be aware of any such classifications in international law. However, Excellencies, there does exist a classification between a state actor in international law enjoying the international legal personality and a non-state actor in international law.
Is there a recognition of the principle of state in exile in legal practice?
Indeed, Your Excellencies, there is a concept of state in exile.
What are the legal consequences arising out of recognition of the concept of state in exile?
Yes, Your Excellencies, a state in exile is a concept which recently has been seen with the case of Somalia. But Your Excellencies, such a concept, the agents for respondents submit, could not apply in this case because the prime requirement for such a concept to trigger him is the presence of an illegal government in situ, that is, in the territory where control was stated. And here, Your Excellencies,
I'll make you a job quickly, sir. Whether the statehood has to be discussed further into the exercise of jurisdiction in this court or some other. The question of statehood in the present case should be discussed vis-a-vis exercise of jurisdiction of this court or some other general assembly.
With respect to the video,
please take you along.
Indeed, yes, this is with respect to jurisdiction of this court because it was submission.
So, Malta case, what is it? Malta, you are given of Malta will not help you.
Your Excellency, Malta is not supposed to even help us because.
And also the non state actor principle will not.
Your Excellency, that is the very contention of the respondent, is that this court cannot exercise jurisdiction over this case. And therefore, Your Excellency, these concepts would never even in any case help us. But just to address the queries of the defense, I address those issues. Our submission is under Article 34.
Because of us only, you did not argue properly. Because of the court. You did not argue properly.
Your Excellencies, our submission is that under Article 34(1) only states can be parties to dispute before this court and the applicant in its current state is not a state in international.
If your convention is accepted, then there
would
be no meaning
for civil
dialogue issues.
Indeed, Your Excellencies, in that case, all the rest arguments would be in and the court would have no jurisdiction.
So we think about a hypothetical issue.
Indeed, yes.
Suppose you imagine that you are a nuclear power.
Indeed, yes. Sir.
You form that territory.
Indeed.
There is no territory.
Indeed.
They cannot come before us that you have bound to them illegally because they don't have territory. Can we accept that argument?
Yes.
Because necessary, it is necessary to have territory. You have destroyed the territory. There is no territory. Now you say they cannot come before ICJ because they don't have territory. Is that your argument?
Your Excellency.
Yes, sir.
Your Excellency, it would, in such a situation, it would be.
That is what my present advice to you. Territory, actual territory, or what is that? States in exile, all these questions are focusing on that point.
Your Excellencies, in that case, even though international law would not recognize that as a state because population and genetic group.
We are not concerned with international, we are concerned about jurisdiction of this court. That's what you said. That's what I gave you a clue. We are not concerned about what is international state. We are discussing, we are entertaining an argument with reference to this gate. We exercise our power.
Excellencies, in that case, it would be up to the court to decide if it can hear a dispute regarding that and whether it would consider such.
Whether you have any argument with reference to Article 93 of UN Charter?
The excellencies, we further submit that because territory and population in this case would not be fulfilled, therefore, it would cease to, this practice, it would cease to be a member of the United Nations and thus also cut the party to the ICC statute. Because as stated by President Higgins, to be a member of the United Nations, a state has to fulfill the four traditional criteria of state. That is good.
If you want to be a member of the United Nations, the criteria is different. You should be a peace-loving state under Article 1 and 2 of UN Charter.
Yes, we'll see.
The only criteria of United Nations membership is you should be a peace-loving state.
Yes, it is definitely that, but with respect to constituting the definition.
So, you are speaking to Moot Media Convention or UN Charter practice?
The excellency is, the submission is twofold. First, with respect to state, where I will be addressing this court that is that the requirements under the Moot Media Convention are not.
Yes. So you say it is a customary law?
Yes.
So any one of the requirements is breached, then they loses. That point is well taken.
Yes, you see the second is that.
That's what this court cannot exercise jurisdiction because they don't have state. This is Article 34 of the ICC statute. That point is well taken.
Yes, you see second would be that with respect, since it ceases to be a state, it would also cease to be a member of the United Nations and thus an ipso facto party to the ICC statute.
That is where we ask that. We cannot amaze what is the state practice authority regarding that. Once you lose the state court, you are automatically will lose your membership. Then what is authority?
The excellency, in cases of extension of state,
withdrawal of membership is permissible under UN.
The excellency in the state,
withdrawal of membership is permissible under UN. It was permissible under League of Nations, that is why League of Nations was a failure. No withdrawal of membership is permissible under UN. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
There is no withdrawal of membership.
But excellency,
expression is there?
Yes, yes.
When is there which?
If 2/3 of the members of the United Nations agree to it, a state can.
So it is a political question or a legal question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. This would be a political question.
Can we decide a political question? Can we decide a political question?
Indeed, yes, sir. This court can decide.
Yes.
Yes, and then with that,
no, who has the burden of ruling that the state is in the existence or not? Who has the burden?
Yes, and since we are contending
that it. Is the last one.
Since we are challenging that the applicant exists in the state, we would go on to state how it's not a state. And we take.
And what is the standard of proof required?
Pardon me?
Standard of proof. What is the standard of proof required in such cases? When you are attempting to establish that it is not a state, applicant is not a state, what is the standard of proof by which you prove that applicant is not a state?
The excellencies, as I have been showing, what is the standard of proof required in international law? The excellencies, can you clarify?
What is the standard of proof required in international law?
What is the evidence you are using towards? What is the evidence?
The excellencies,
to prove your case, the standard of evidence. You are going to use to prove your case.
The excellencies, I think,
I'm trying to clarify on the basic and the ICC has lost its territory and so it is not
a
state. So, what is the extent of evidence that you may use to show that
the ICC
has lost its territory?
The excellencies, with respect to that, we have been addressing this court on various parts from the compromise, specifically paragraph 25 and 44, where both these islands are submerged. We also have been referred to paragraph 45 of the compromise, which would deal with the lease and the subsequent lease.
That is compromise.
Yes, this compromise is a document by which both the parties accept the jurisdiction of the
court. There is compromise required in the statute of this court.
Yes, this is under Article 56(1). Of the ICC court statute, it implicitly defines compromise by reference to special agreement.
What are the other modes by which we can exercise
Your Excellencies, in case of 26-2, which will be compulsory jurisdiction of this court, if a party has accepted the compulsory jurisdiction of this court, for the Excellencies, another evidence under 36-1 would be the Excellencies where treaties provide and the parties have beforehand accepted the jurisdiction. This court can also give an advisory opinion on a particular subject.
Yes,
much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, thus, is submitted that the applicant has no territory, and NASA team, although NASA team Islands does not satisfy the definition of territory for the purpose of international law. As Your Excellency, I stated earlier, the definition of territory in international law would be a defined area over which a state exercises activities, and as again citing development of international political organs of the UN and Professor James Crawford and Sir Professor Sir Ian Brownlee, such activities should not be regulated by any other state.
Suppose the territory is annexed by the alien.
In the
hostile state.
In the
present state, and after 1 month, the state reclaims the territory.
Indeed.
So, what is the position in international law during that 1 month period?
Yes,
suppose I have a territory X. It has been annexed by state B.
Indeed.
And again, PKPKP, I get it done.
Indeed.
So, during 1 month period, I have lost my territory.
Indeed.
So during that 1 month period, I have lost my statehood order.
Yes, and see,
what is it? It is temporary loss, a suspension, or permanent loss?
Yes, and see, at the first instance, it would be temporary loss. And for the excellencies, the annexed state cannot hold it as their territory because, yes, and see, in today's time, as said by Professor Crawford in his thesis, Creation of States in International Law, illegal annexation in today's time cannot be the very existence of the state.
Now what is the impact of the Vienna Convention on succession of the government?
The Excellencies, in the current case there is no succession. And therefore, Excellencies, that treaty would not
apply. Why do you say that there is no succession?
The Excellencies, my answer to this is twofold. First, the Vienna Convention itself defines succession as one state replacing another state in its legal obligation. And second, Excellencies, quoting Professor James Crawford from his Creation of International Law in States, and from 8th edition of Sir Ian Brownlee edited by Professor Crawford, such significant changes in territory, governments, populations cannot be construed as succession for the purpose of international.
So what you say from this proposition? That territory has a relevance only for constitution of statehood, and after statehood has been formed, territory is irrelevant.
Yes, you see, this is another quote by Professor Crawford. But yes, since it's seen with incomplete reference, complete context to what Professor Crawford has been stated talking. He's been talking about international legal personality and not per se in reference to statehood. What he addresses is legal personality. And even though territory is lost, legal personality is not lost.
That's what may I ask a question?
May I proceed? Much obliged, yes. And yes, since in the case of NASA team islands, since essential sovereign functions, as we have, Mr. President has earlier pointed out, such as defense, immigration, law saving, customs.
Every point of properties.
And yes, this is further reiterated by the company, are subject to freedom of control, yes. And therefore, since these very activities are regulated by another state, NASA team islands cannot fall under the definition of territory as required by international law. Excellencies, further with regards to if I've satisfied Excellency at one point due to positive time, should I move to my other submission or satisfy
you? We don't have jurisdiction to pass any interim measures.
Pardon?
We don't have jurisdiction to pass any interim orders.
Indeed, yes.
So we can't say whether we are satisfied.
Excellencies, Article 41
does. You have to presume. So we have a grosser orders.
Excellencies, no. I asked the bench in. They want you to proceed with that.
You don't even know the orders. You have to continue. You are a representative of an independent nation.
Indeed.
Absolutely.
Yes, Excellencies, therefore, I will now move on to the issue of population. Yes, Excellencies, now, permanent population is another requirement of statehood as enumerated by the Constitutive Convention. Now, what is permanent population? Permanent population under international law, as stated by Professor Oppenheim, is a group of people inhabiting a territory as a community. Now, yes, this is in the current case, as far as NASA Team Islands is concerned, paragraph 25 clearly indicates that it has no population. Yes, this is that therefore, even at the current state, the requirement of permanent population is not going to be. Therefore, since two essential requirements of statehood are not met, the applicant ceases to be a state for the purpose of it. nationalized. Therefore, this very court cannot exercise jurisdiction with respect to these claims. Yes, sir, may I, if I address the question,
then even if it is not a state, indeed, if the applicant continues as a member to the United Nations Charter, he can place an issue before this court, and this court can exercise jurisdiction.
The excellencies, if it's a member of the United Nations, definitely the agents for this one cannot contend that it cannot appear before the court, because by the very fact that it's a member of the United Nations, Article 93 provides that it would be an ex officio party to the ICC statute. But the excellency, as I earlier stated, that the very fact that it ceases to be a state, it will also cease to be a member of the United Nations, because its existence ceases to be a member of the party.
Now the question as to whether it has ceased to be a state is a matter to be answered by us. Before answering by us, I prefer to say that it has ceased to be a state and that it has ceased to become a member of the United
States. Yes, these are just the arguments. This is for the court to decide whether it finds so and whether or not the applicant is a state for the purpose of international law. Yes, Mr. May I proceed to my question? Much obliged. Now, Yes, Mr. The second contention is without prejudice to the first contention and states that the applicant, in the hypothetical, if it does exist as a state, is precluded from making any claims with regard to these displaced individuals so far as to be residing in the respondent state. Yes, Mr. Post submerging of these islands, all but 3,000 people were relocated, and these 3,000 people found their way into the respondent state, where the applicant contends they have been subjected to certain human rights violations. It is submitted that the applicant is precluded from bringing a claim on their behalf if it exists as a state. The essence is to show this are proving two things: that first, these individuals are stateless individuals for the purpose of international law, and second, excellencies, a claim cannot be extended on their behalf. Now, excellencies, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, in its expert meeting at Brussels, has stated that currently, as far as statelessness is concerned, there is an exception to the traditional law of statelessness.
There is also an international principle of protection of statelessness.
Indeed, yes.
Recognizing international.
Indeed,
and how you are acting with the different side of this concept.
The essence is, now that is the convention that provides for this, the convention, both these conventions regarding statelessness are from the year 54 to 61. Now, the essence is the United Nations High Commission for Refugees, very recently, 2010, has addressed the issues of statelessness and international law at present time. With respect to the current scenario, it stated there that in certain circumstances, especially with regard to bringing up claims, the absences, persons who are unable to return to the country of nationality, even in cases where they are able to pass or in full to obtain the protection, diplomatic protection in the state of their country, would amount in the case that they cannot return back to the country that is willing to exercise claim on their behalf, would amount as stateless persons for the purpose of international and diplomatic
protection.
Disappearance
of a state territory in the one account of violence is an important act as to be distinguished from disappearance of territory in the voluntary act.
Indicate.
That is so. Does not the territory continue or assume to continue?
First, I'll address the question on this, that as stated in paragraph 10, the respondent state has worked to reduce its emissions. And secondly, excellencies, as far as
what are the precautionary measures undertaken by you?
The excellencies, with respect to that, the compromise says that it has worked to reduce its emissions. And secondly, excellencies, the other measure, other obligations under the UNFCCC that we have fully.
You know,
and
as under an obligation,
are you
not
having
an obligation to take care of
the
animals?
The excellencies, the blame regarding global warming cannot be attributed on the respondent state because the FNC
is
the form.
What is the special protection measures necessary if the law has something in declaration?
Pardon me?
It offers law like items. It offers law like items. Some protective portions are incorporated in the law has something in declaration. What is the specific portion provided in respect of law like items which are remaining in a world conference stage based on the fact of extinction?
Your Excellencies, developed countries especially that are contributing to the issue of global warming are under an obligation to assist them, to help them. Your Excellencies and the applicant and the respondent have, at the very start, since the issue, applicant has been a low-lying island facing the issue of submergence in a pretty large time. And your Excellencies, the respondent state has the very fact that the loan agreement is with respect to their help, helping them cope up with the issue of climate change. Is an evidence that we have fulfilled that obligation, that to assist them, to assist the low-lying island. The Excellencies, in this case, what is challenged is that assuming Nasa Tima Islands is what constitutes territory for the purpose of the African state, in that case, these individuals cannot return there and therefore they are stateless people as far as diplomatic protection is concerned. The Excellencies, paragraph 48(3). Paragraph 41, along with 48 of the compromise, as well as the Excellencies, the prayer, where they have not asked for these individuals to be given back to the applicant, clearly indicate that these individuals in the current state cannot return back to the applicant state, and therefore, the Excellencies, these
what is the essential link to exercise diplomatic protection? What is the essential criteria for exercising diplomatic protection?
Excellency, as I stated in the Basque attraction case, with regard to diplomatic protection, the essential criteria is nationality. Excellency, and
therefore, they do not choose nationality.
Indeed.
They cannot be considered as stateless person.
Indeed.
And as long as they enjoy nationality, the country of origin is not excluded from exercising diplomatic protection.
Yes, Excellency, indeed, that's
so
what
diplomatic protection is not, it deals with
indeed, Excellencies, but actually, as far as many claims are concerned, as if an individual cannot return back to that very country, the Excellencies, at that current instance, that individual ceases to lose its effective link with the country. There is no genuine link at the current stage because this individual.
Who decides the link? The individual or the state?
The Excellencies, these things are definitely decided. The link of nationality. Nationality is an issue of domestic law, that's not contention.
So it deals with the country of origin.
Pardon?
The country of origin decides whether so-and-so has nationality or not.
Indeed, yes.
So it does not deal with the persons who are residing somewhere outside the territory.
Indeed, yes. But that's what is contended, that even though a state is willing to avail an individual is getting diplomatic protection.
For example, if a foreigner comes to India.
Indeed, yes.
So he doesn't want to go back to America. Whether America can exercise diplomatic protection with the Saudi state.
The Excellency, in that case, this individual has because this
consular assistance, the case of consular assistance decided by the ICD, the Deputy versus US. In the
right
of the jurisprudence, please answer this question.
The Excellency.
Consular assistant case,
indeed.
Germany versus United States.
Indeed, Iran case.
I recommend you the citation. I'm sorry, I like this question. Moreover, paragraph 48 clearly says, performance in Trinidad and elsewhere petitioned.
Indeed, yes.
So therefore, there is no break of link.
But at the current, this is with respect to 3,000 individuals. Yes, see, right now these individuals cannot go back to their country. And yes, see, the applicant in Surana has not asked them also to be returned back to this country. And therefore, since in the existing state, they cannot go back to their country. And therefore, since there does not exist that genuine.
That does not preclude them to ask you for minimum treatment of that.
Yes, see, I would want to show how no, there has been no breach of international law as far as treatment and processing is concerned.
What is your duty vis-a-vis the country of origin? With reference to migrants.
Yes, you see, as far as any individual is concerned.
They cannot be treated as stateless, as considered by people. Because stateless doesn't deal with the persons who are away from their
citizens. The rights that are afforded is same to everyone in international law, even if they are stateless. And yes, you see, agents for the respondent would want to show how all processing and detention of these migrants are not a violation of international law and what is with the very principles of international law.
So you are done with the legal status within the trade?
The excellencies are
not the standing of the applicant state, but bringing the claim, you are done with the government.
The excellencies that is submitted as since these are stateless people, as I have pointed out, a claim cannot be exercised on their behalf.
So the stateless person will be decided based on the individual or based on the perception of the state, conferring state.
The excellencies that individual cannot decide it, but the excellencies the state in that instance cannot bring a claim on their behalf because the excellencies, as was stated by the United States Mexican Claim Tribunal, there can be no diplomatic protection with respect to a stateless individual.
Can there be a state in a stateless state? Can there be a state in a stateless state?
The excellency says stateless is an issue between individuals. This concept would not extend to states. The excellency is but assuming but not conceding.
When is statelessness arise?
The excellency statelessness can arise in a lot of instances where, especially where the person ceases to be a national of another state.
When that happens? When a person ceases to be a national?
The excellency is in cases where there is an extension of the state or in case of succession, but your excellency will risk.
Please understand what is the useful regarding statelessness and nationalism. What are the international principles dealing with statelessness?
The excellency, statelessness is a person who is not concerned with
international documents or treaty or whatever.
The excellency, there are two conventions, the 3.61 convention, one dealing with the status of stateless people, the other dealing with
the status. From that use, for still explain that person ceases to be a, ceases to be a national of a particular country.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir.
Yes.
Out that an individual would be.
You never point out anything, we seek clarification.
Your excellency, as stated by this convention, and a person who is stateless, this would be stateless, would be a person who is not considered national by any state. So
the declaration has to come from the country,
indeed.
So and so is not a
national of that state.
Where is it given in our.
The excellency, but however, I stated that this is a convention from 54, and the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees has stated that law has evolved with respect to diplomatic protection. And when it comes to exercising claims on behalf of those individuals that cannot go back to the country of their nationality, even though they are
temporarily or permanently.
The excellency, at that very least, will.
That is not given as a report. Temporarily or permanently. That report is silent about it.
Any excellency, then. The excellency, so if the entire report is considered in its entirety,
that entire report is only a subsidy resource of international law, and that entire report is silent about whether it is temporary statelessness or permanent statelessness. So therefore, what is the persuasive effect of that?
The excellency, again, without prejudice to my other two arguments that was raised before this court, these individuals have been afforded treatment in accordance with international law and respond. Has not violated international law and processing and treatment of these individuals. The excellencies to prove this, I will show you four things. First, that the intersection of these illegal immigrants is permissible by international law. Second, excellencies, that the detention of these individuals is justified by international law. Third, the countermeasure as a circumstance precluding as wrongfulness is provided in the article on responsibility for states for wrongful acts, the excellencies. And a countermeasure may be used, the excellencies, as far as it mitigates the wrongful act is concerned by a state that has faced illegal damage or who has seen a breach which serves its own legal obligation. Excellencies, that's the relevance of countermeasures for the position of countermeasures in international.
What do you say they are legal?
The excellency, since these individuals have entered the territory of the respondent state, contrary to the immigration laws, as clearly pointed out in paragraph 50 and speech in the General Assembly, these are illegal immigrants. They have not sought any permissions to enter the respondent state, and therefore, these are illegal immigrants.
They have a right to asylum or to seek asylum as alleged by the
excellency, that would only be instance if they are refugees. And the excellency, in this case, case, they would not fall under the definition of refugees. And
there is an evolving jurisprudence of eco-refugees, environmental refugees.
But Your Excellencies, Professor J. Natari, Professor Guy Goodwin has stated, for the UN of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees has stated that that people who have been displaced due to natural events or environmentally displaced people would not fall under the definition of refugees that is enumerated in the 51 Convention.
On this environmentally displaced persons were addressed with reference to drought, severe drought, not with reference to climate change.
Your Excellencies,
that has been clearly stated in the preamble, the proceeding with the introduction.
Your Excellencies, but
regard the environmental refugees can be put under two headings. One, because of the drought they are moving, therefore they are called environmental refugees. Second thing is they are also moving because of seeking of livelihood. Therefore, they cannot be called as refugees. That was the argument put forth in the case. But here we have a people who are not fleeing the country for want of life, not want of livelihood, for protect their right to life. So that is the peculiarity about this
country. Yes, you see, nonetheless, these individuals would not get protection under the 51 Convention
What are the two essential conditions? There should be a persecution.
Indeed, sir.
Fear of persecution by the state.
By the state.
Forget about by the state.
Yes.
There is a fear of death. Yes. By natural calamity of fury, natural security. So whether a state is under the climate convention, whether is there any obligation, and emerging jurisprudence is there to conferring them a right to seek asylum or right to
asylum. Yes, this very call when the applicant was arguing to reject the judgment.
What is about your shared responsibility? Shared responsibility of the respondent?
Yes.
Provide asylum to the government of refugees.
The Excellency, the current position in international law is that these individuals, climatically displaced individuals, do not have the right to asylum. This has been, the Excellency,
that the root cause of their displacement or dislocation is attributable to factors from within the experiences of the respondents. When the root cause of their displacement or evacuation is attributable to factors within the territory of the respondents.
As I earlier answered Your Excellency's question, that such blame for climatic change or the disappearance of the applicant cannot be attributed to the respondent because the company does not, number one, provide any clear indication of Kyoto or even FCC violations. Let me secondly, what the company states is that the applicant has worked to lessen its
to borrow heavily to improve your freedom and deficit, isn't it?
Pardon me?
To borrow heavily.
Indeed, yes, yes.
To construct some improvement. They resulted in climate change. That's not the complications.
Yes, yes, yes.
So there is no direct reference, but indirect reference for
the Excellencies, that is, the entire blame still cannot be attributed to the responsibility particularly. And further this, there is still not an evidence, emissions are there, but it is not an evidence that the UNFCCC or the Kyoto has.
There is scientific evidence for that, but what else we need to talk of apart from the compromise? Compromise clearly says that these things can't be treated for global warming. You want a scientific data for that? Apart from the compromise?
Your Excellency, given that in that case, Your Excellency, the applicant has failed to establish that how, particularly only from the respondent's emissions, have they been hampered. Your Excellency,
we think that what is the standard? Rather than that, that is the standard of proof in international law.
Your Excellency, since they are challenging.
Especially dealing with state responsibility.
Your Excellency, since they are challenging if what for that they have been affected by the response, it's the onus of them to prove that they have been affected.
Where it is said, that onus is on them. There is authority in international law, onus is on them. Up to channel case?
Yes,
sir. Idea.
Yes, the Excellency, I'm unaware of that.
Exactly.
The Excellency is further moving on that these individuals, nonetheless, whatever the status, they are entitled to certain rights as given by the ICC. We are for other such people. And Your Excellency, these rights in the current case have not been violated. The Excellency, with regard to detention, first, that the detention of these individuals is justified under international law. Your Excellency, these individuals have entered in response to FTP. There is no contesting that. The SNCs, the United Nations Human Rights Council and AWS Australia has stated that if an individual does enter a country illegally, he can be justified. The SNCs further, the United Nations Human Rights Council in another case has stated that the reason for administrative detention of
the individual case dealing with the individual can be extended to group of people in international. An individual illegal migrant.
Maybe.
The jurisprudence regarding an illegal individual migrant, whether that jurisprudence can be extended to proof of migrants.
The Excellency, international law is devoid of any authority when a very large number such as the current case has entered. But
so individual case, we are very close.
The Excellency, but in these cases that had appeared before the human HRC, not such large groups, but smaller groups had appeared. The claim was on behalf of only one individual. But in both these instances, the detention was with respect to 25 people around that. The excellencies, therefore, in these cases, it's been provided that the very nature of illegal entry gives the right to stay to detain them for administration purposes because the excellencies, it's believed that they cannot detain but release it into the international community, there will be a strong incentive for them. Yes. Incentive for them not to adhere to the conditions of release and abscond in the territory. Therefore, since the very fact that the individuals have illegally entered a country is a ground for another.
That's the only reason? Because they entered
the country. Supplementing this is another reason. The excellencies in Mansour versus Turkey and Germania versus France, the United Nations, the European Court of Human Rights have stated that a reason for pretrial detention can be suspicion of a criminal offence. The excellencies in this current case, as clearly highlighted by the facts of the case, claim the suspicion that these individuals have been involved in financing illegal activities from the borders of the border state. The excellencies in this calls for another reason to investigate and added reason for a pre-trial detention. Our question that might appear in the mind of the excellencies is that the period of detention.
What is the difference between arrest and detention under
the excellencies, arrest would only.
Because you raised pre-arrest detention.
Pre-trial. The excellencies, pre-trial detention would be any.
Well, you could have arrested them. If you are suspicious of their activities, you could have arrested them and put them in the jail instead of detaining them in camps.
Yes, the excellencies, in this current case, since these charges weren't proved, there was a need for investigation, therefore, these individuals are detained rather than a formal process. And
what is the difference between arrest and detention?
The excellencies, detention as defined by the jurisprudence of the United Nations.
One confers civilian status.
Pardon?
One confers deals with civilian status.
And the other with criminal status. Yes. The excellencies, detention can be for various reasons, whereas arrest can only be for a criminal reason. Detention can also be for administrative reasons.
Does that make your argument?
The excellencies, just this point that the period of detention would not be violated of international law. Because the excellencies in two cases, W versus Switzerland and J versus Switzerland, it was stated that periods of detention as long as 4 years would not be in violation of international law. In cases, the excellencies, the number of individuals are very large or due to the complexity of this case. In this case, the excellencies, these individuals have been detained for roughly 2 years. The excellencies in J versus Switzerland, when 11 individuals were detained for 4 years, the court had found that it could not be a violation of international law due to the number
detention
of.
Detention and arbitrary detention. That is the case they have raised. So it is not a simple detention. It is an arbitrary detention without any state period, whether it is amounting to violation of international law.
The excellencies, arbitrary detention, the prime requirements for an arbitrary detention would be if the detention one, as provided in the stockholder versus Australia case, would be one if the detention is not justified. Now, this detention is justified for both administrative reasons as well as for a criminal suspicion. Now, essentially, the second requirement would be
every state will say that our human rights record is good. Every state will say that our human rights record is good. What is the international principle regarding this?
Regarding excellencies?
Arbitrary detention.
Yes, see, that's what I'm stating, that arbitrary detention enforces requirements as stated by the United Nations Human Rights Council, that this detention, number one, has to be justified, which has been justified. Secondly, excellencies, this has to be in accordance with laws. My excellencies, paragraph 50 of the compromise states that all these individuals have been detained and processed according to the laws.
Principle laws.
Indeed.
The
excellencies, these people, the entire detention has to be carried out in accordance with the laws present. And last is that this detention should not violate a period that is not being justifiable, and 4 years as stated by the United Nations Human Rights Council in a case where the number of detainees was sufficiently large was held not to be violated.
In some cases of that, there are maybe even 4 days is illegal.
Indeed, Excellency.
Thank you.
Your Excellency, it was a pleasure to come here to discuss this question.
Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you for your
My first submission in the instant case of essence is threefold, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, my first submission being international law mandates me to transfer these people, Your Excellency. Secondly, I will agree with the entire submission. The applicant statement show how it is devoid of all merit, Your Excellency. Thirdly, assuming but not conceding, fourth, my submission rejects me, I will state how international threshold still does not prohibit me to transfer these persons, Your Excellency. My first submission as to how I am mandated to transfer these people in accordance with my international law obligations, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, with respect to this, I would like to cite Article 15 of the ICSE law, Your Excellency.
You are an agent. You have to report on respondent state. I am
extremely apologetic, Your Excellency.
So the respondent agent, you can use the word, you could become Australia or respondent state.
I'm extremely apologetic, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the agent on behalf of the respondent state would submit a few provisions of international law, Your Excellency, Article 15 of the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, Article 27 of the ICCPR, Article 22 and 27 of the UDHR, read with the UN Charter, Article 55 and 56. Your Excellency, what are these provisions? These provisions deal with protection of cultural rights of individual citizens, individual persons, and their rights to dignity, to live as a community, and their right to ensure the survival and the continuity of that group of people, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, with reference to that, I would also like to cite two authorities, Your Excellency, Onai versus Canada, and L versus Finland, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, this dealt with what is the right to culture, Your Excellency.
You also have to provide citation.
Sorry, Your Excellency.
If you cite a decision, you have to provide citation also.
I apologize. Your Excellency, Onai versus Canada was this decision of 1984, Your Excellency, and Finland versus Finland was a decision of 2005, Your Excellency, of the UN Human Rights Committee, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, what did it say? It stated that a right to enjoy one's own culture can only meaningfully be carried out when exercised in community with others, Your Excellency. With other members of that group, I apologize, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, who are these Marathi co-villagers, people, Your Excellency? I'd like to draw attention to paragraph 3 of the compromise in the instant case, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, with your permission, I'd like to quote, Your Excellency. If Your Excellency is allowed me to answer, would like to proceed. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, I quote from paragraph 3. Nulatri Grove was a coastal village or Indian whose residents had lived in isolation from other islanders since mid-19th century. They were of the same culture and ethnic origin as other Algonquins, but rejected urbanization and technology. Your Excellency, when they reached our territorial borders, when they reached our state, we were perplexed with a certain issue about compliance with international law, Your Excellency. They put forth a request before us that since they were a certain group of people who had respected their own ethnicity and they wanted to continue maintaining that dignity and identity of a group of people, what did they put forth before us? They put forth that they wanted to be housed together. Therefore,
they maintained a subsistence.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Your Excellency.
You are completely forgetting the next sentences. So So then if you, have you provided a sufficient measure to them?
Your Excellency, we have provided with the international human rights obligations as mandated, Your Excellency. As
the respondent state is concerned with their cultural identity, whether you have provided their perceptions of pleasure.
Your Excellency, due to...
Right to livelihood or right to life?
Your Excellency, in the instant case of factual scenarios being limited, if I cannot affirmatively say yes or no, Your Excellency...
When there is a clash between right to life and right to cultural rights, which right will prevail?
Your Excellency, much obliged for your question, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, in the instant case, the respondent state submission is that we are protecting their right to life and there is no harm to their right to life, Your Excellency. We are protecting their right to culture and there is no harm to their right to life, Your Excellency. Therefore, there being no perplexity as to which obligation would supersede over the other, Your Excellency. Proceeding further, on about 15 April 2011, Your Excellency, there was an earthquake in the region, Your Excellency, and I quote this paragraph 37 of the compromise. I apologize, Your Excellency, 15th November 2011, there was an earthquake in the region which structurally destroyed the block in which these persons were detained, the Nulathiro village, Your Excellency. Therefore, we had no choice but to transfer them to the state of Sali, who was volunteering to accept the transfer of these persons. We could not fulfill our obligations to continue maintaining them together as one cultural unit, Your Excellency. Therefore, to comply with our cultural obligations, we had to transfer them to the state of Sali, Your Excellency. Proceeding further, Your Excellency. Now, assuming but not conceding my first submission, I would put forth what is the applicant submission in the incident case. The applicant submission deals with mainly two paragraphs of the compromise. Paragraph 40, with respect to a World Elimination Watch. Your Excellency, I'd like to highlight that it is a October 2011 report of the World Elimination Watch. Your Excellency, there to it, paragraph 10. Your Excellency, in the World Elimination Watch report, as contended by the applicant state, there were certain violations of human rights obligations. There's an allegation that there were certain cases reported of abuse also, Your Excellency. That led to
the
international
law.
Your Excellency, it is our submission that all these merits, as stated, would be devoid, Your Excellency, because the respondent state and the state of society has provided an assurance that these issues would not happen again, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the second grievance, as seen in paragraph 10 to the clarification of the complaint, also deal with certain violations of their rights. Your Excellency, to ensure that these rights are not violated, what did the respondent state do in the incident case, Your Excellency? Your Excellency, we put forth these reservations to the state of society. We put them forth, and there that a recognition of that in the compromise is seen in paragraph 38 in the compromise, Your Excellency. Where we took it upon ourselves, and I quote from the fact sheet, the agreement provided that all costs associated with the transfer, detention, health, and welfare of the transferees would be met by Russia. Your Excellency, therefore, there was an immediate provision of funds that was given from the respondent state to the state of Saudi. There is this obligation coupled with the obligation of the state of Saudi, stating that as soon as liquidity is provided to us, we would make that expenditure. Therefore, all these reservations, Your Excellency, specifically only two reservations in two paragraphs of the factual compromise, dealing with proposed or alleged violations of human rights, have been met by the respondent state. Therefore, any argument put forth by the application is devoid of any merit. Your Excellency, assuming but not conceding.
That is a very technical argument, not a legal argument at all.
Yes, Your Excellency,
we are arguing on a technical issue, so don't have any legal issue.
Yes, Your Excellency, now assuming but not conceding that these.
Too technical, don't you think that is too technical?
Your Excellency, these assurances.
You don't have any legal argument.
Yes, Your Excellency, I am proceeding to my legal argument, assuming that I do not stand on any merit. The law still does not prohibit me from.
You are an agent of a state, you stand on your merit. Why do you waste your time on technical issues? What is the legal issue?
My humble submission would be, if I could draw attention to page 24 of my written submissions, my submission 4.2 in the incident case. Your Excellency, to prohibit me to transfer these persons, there are two thresholds mandated in international law through jurisprudence, Your Excellency. These two thresholds are, there should be a personal risk of torture. Secondly, there should be a substantial risk of torture beyond mere theories and mere suspicion. Your Excellency, now I have few jurisprudence.
The applicant's contention is with reference to against the wishes of the people you are transiting to send, and also against the wishes of the country of origin. Country of origin is city state. You can transfer to any particular territory except this site. So we have a legal argument on this issue.
Your Excellency, Your Excellency, if I first address Madam Excellency's question. Your Excellency, Madam Excellency, I apologize. In the incident case, we have taken all the track records of the state of Saizi into consideration. We have taken that into consideration. We put forth that to the state of Saizi, and we have ensured that those will not happen again. Moving forward, Your Excellency, we have stated that all costs, all the expenditure related to the... Your Excellency, the respondent state has put these reservations to the state of Saizi, and Saizi has stated that they would implement this money to ensure that all the cases of alleged malnutrition and other cases do not take place again. Your Excellency, therefore, Your Excellency, at paragraph 38 in the compromise, which I quoted, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, it states that because the respondent state could not accommodate the housing requests of the Ratri for villagers, an agreement was entered into with the Republic of Saizi to transfer all these detainees. And Your Excellency, the last sentence being imperative, Your Excellency, the agreement provided that all costs associated with the transfer. Your Excellency, this assurance, read to which the assurance?
There is a catch word here. Costs to buy Saizi's immigration.
Yes, sir.
What is the implication meaning?
Your Excellency,
you are transferring somebody else to some country. So they are subjected to some country's immigration. What is the implication?
Your Excellency, they would be housed in the detention.
They have done independently on behalf of their trust. So when you pass through Saizi's immigration, that means you are taking individual responsibility, or you are acting on behalf of the applicants, or having responsibility. From the Saizi's point of view.
Your Excellency, I apologize,
you will be representing India, that is why I inquired. You will not be, we are not going to continue. Later on, you can please. You can stick to your argument. You can use I also. That's only a polite way, but switch around, don't use it. Now I will be allowed. You can stick on to your business.
I respond to the agent on behalf of the respondent state. The agent on behalf of the respondent state humbly apologizes. Your Excellency, the agent on behalf of the respondent humbly states that we have taken up the responsibility that all costs associated with the transfer would be met by the respondent state. The state of Saizi has also coupled this with an assurance that as soon as they get the money, they would effectuate this expenditure into the maintaining and housing of the Arjunian migrants, Your Excellency. Moving forward, I'd like to show how international law still does not prohibit me, assuming that these merits still stand, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the two questions.
They have been housed in the existing facilities, not in the new facilities.
Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, but the liquidity provided in the incident case by the respondent state so as to improve these facilities was already given, Your Excellency. All costs associated with health, welfare, all expenses.
The cost of welfare is very cheap then.
Your Excellency,
that would not make a dent in your pocket.
Your Excellency, if I may actually cite that the respondent state is spending double the money to maintain these people, Your Excellency.
For example, if Saizi is providing only, instead of 3 square meals, they are providing 1 square meal, then your expenditure will be less.
Your Excellency,
that reason you are transferring to Saizi.
Your Excellency, we are transferring the state of Saizi for one reason only, that international law permits us to transfer them, Your Excellency. If I may state how we are spending double the money in actually transferring them.
International law prohibits you to transfer them against the wishes of the individuals, non-refular. That is what we are seeking your legal argument.
Your Excellency, if I may first ask a question regarding the financial aspect, Your Excellency.
No, forget about it.
Much
better. That is the place of the class. Now we are moving to the
Your Excellency, the principle of non-refoulement prevents me to transfer them in two cases. When there is a personal risk of torture, and when that risk of torture is of a substantial nature, Your Excellency.
It need not be. There need not be any personal available risk of torture. It is non-refoulement simply says, voluntarily there should be transfer. Yeah, yes, sir, that's it. It is not a question of what is going to happen there, or it is not a, that is not a question.
Your Excellency is agent on behalf of the respondents. They would like to respectfully disagree, Your Excellency, the principle of
non-refoulement.
Your Excellency, the principle of non-refoulement means in case as these persons, as dealt with by my co-agent, are refugees, the principle of non-refoulement being implicitly then by Article 6 and 7 of the ICCPR, Your Excellency. Therefore, the only requirement being we have to ensure that their human rights are not violated, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, there is only one requirement to ensure that no human rights have been violated when an implicit reference has been drawn through Article 7 of the ICCPR. Therefore, Your Excellency, there would be only two thresholds in the incident case, being one of personal risk and being one of high threshold, risk of high threshold, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, both those thresholds have not been met in the incident case. There is no personal risk of torture in the incident case. If I may quote two authorities in the incident case, one being Tala versus Sweden, which is the decision of the Committee of Convention Against Torture. Your Excellency, the facts of that case was that there was a member of the Mujahideen organization. He was arrested. He was arrested by the local police authorities. His family did not know about his whereabouts. He was tortured. He escaped that. The detention facility by the local authorities was found in Sweden. Your Excellency, even then, there was held to be no personal risk of torture. Another case I'd like to cite, Your Excellency, HLR versus France, which is a decision of the UN Human Rights Committee report, a UN Human Rights Committee of 2001. What were the facts of that case, Your Excellency?
That's not detention in human
conditions about
the torture.
Sorry, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, it is our humble submission that the threshold of risk, the threshold of perceived risk after transfer is one of such a high nature which is not met in the incident case. Therefore, international law permits me to transfer that, Your Excellency.
No,
Your Excellency, as known that the ICCPR is applicable to all persons, irrespective of their status, Your Excellency, it is a humble submission on behalf of the respondent state that no human rights have been violated in the respondent state, neither would there be any violation post-transfer of these persons, Your Excellency. If I have answered Your Excellency, clarification may I proceed. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, in the second case that I was citing, HLR versus France, decision of 2001, at paragraph 46, Your Excellency, it dealt with this factual scenario.
I think you have been harping upon permissive area of international law.
Sorry,
you have been harping upon permissive area of international law. Under international law, I am permitted to visit it. At the same time, international also deals with prohibitive area of international law.
Your Excellency, international law prohibits me to transfer them only when there is a personal risk of torture.
I'm asking you, what is the difference between permissive area of international and prohibitive area of international?
Your Excellency,
is very precise.
Your Excellency's permissibility is when a state is permitted.
Can I answer for that?
Your Excellency, I would not have any jurisprudence to back my answer, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, it would be on the agent's personal interpretation of those. I do not at this moment have any jurisprudence to back any answer.
The entire human rights jurisprudence is a prohibitive thing. Based on prohibitive, you are prevented from doing it. It never authorizes anything to based on that. So that is why this court is seeking this clarification.
Your Excellency, in light of that, Your Excellency, the agent on behalf of the respondent state would rephrase and say that there is no international jurisprudence prohibiting me to transfer them, Your Excellency.
There is no international obligation, that's what you say.
Yes, Your Excellency.
International will never permit you to do anything. So whether you have fulfilled all the international obligations, that is the question.
Your Excellency, if moving further, if I establish that there is the threshold of risk in the incident case being one of a very high nature, is not met in the incident case, therefore there will be no prohibition for me to transfer them, Your Excellency. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may, I apologize, I get back to the HLR citation.
Whether it will
document
any necessity?
Sorry, Your Excellency.
Necessity?
Your Excellency, circumstances precluding wrongfulness cannot be sought in the incident case to avoid or do away with.
Whether under the jurisprudence of the state responsibility, whether even it is out of necessity you are transferring them?
Your Excellency, it is our humble submission, or it is our humble submission on behalf of the respondent state that we are not transferring them out of the state of necessity. We are actually transferring.
There is no necessity at all.
Your Excellency, it is not us.
If
we
are all celebrating them, that's why you are.
Your Excellency, it is not. It is.
Please understand the question and answer. In fact,
Your Excellency, it is very well known jurisprudence that human rights obligations being supreme, Your Excellency, the respondent state is in fact bearing double the cost to maintain these persons. As I was stating earlier, Your Excellency, we are spending $110 million building a new detention center. $110 million building a new detention center, coupled with the fact that we are spending added money to maintain them in the state of Saudi, Your Excellency. We are not citing a state of necessity to preclude wrongfulness or to preclude from our human rights obligations, as we know that these obligations are supreme and cannot be done away with an excuse of financial severity. Your Excellency, moving back to that HLR case that I was citing of paragraph 46, Your Excellency, the personal risk. Your Excellency, in that case, there was an informant who made public information against a Colombian drug lord, Your Excellency. When he was detained in the state of France, that his family was currently receiving death threats. The other person who had informed against the Colombian drug lord had gone to be missing on suspicious circumstances. Therefore, even in light of that, Your Excellency, there was no personal risk of torture. Moving further, Your Excellency, as to what is the high threshold of risk in the incident case. Citing the same jurisprudence, HLR versus Francis Paragraph 41, stated, and I quote, Your Excellency, general violence, incidences of ill-treatment, or reports pertaining to vulnerability have been regarded as insufficient to engage responsibility, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, therefore, even if I lose ground on merits, these are mere general reports or incidences in the incident case and cannot be taken as a threshold to prohibit me to transfer these persons. I'd also like to cite the solemn case, Your Excellency, of 1989 at paragraph 83, Your Excellency. And I quote, Your Excellency, limited to occasions in which treatment or punishment abroad is certain, imminent, or serious, Your Excellency. Therefore, the threshold in the incident case being of an extreme high nature, Your Excellency, the respondent state is not prohibited from transferring them. If I may proceed to my next submission, Your Excellency. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, my last submission being regarding the seizure of assets. Your Excellency, in the incident case, there have been questions raised regarding the bona fide of the respondent state in its behavior from the evening. Your Excellency, if I may guide you to Your Excellencies, the prayer in the compromise at paragraph 55 states Rutasha's conduct disentitles it to any relief, Your Excellency. Therefore, I'd like to, if I may elaborate. Your Excellency, much obliged.
You are interpreting it very narrowly, effectively.
Much obliged.
You are pushing the bona fide of the next discussion.
Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, in the incident case, factually it is clearly stated that the respondent state has always made efforts to reduce its carbon emissions. We have always assisted the applicant state in their dealing with the issues of climate change, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if we gave them a loan of $125 million, it was restructured twice, Your Excellency. It was restructured twice up to almost 50%, Your Excellency, from $125 million currently outstanding. Loan amount is $50 million, Your Excellency, and the amount in the bank account is $20 million. Your Excellency, we made available our scientific resources, our other resources as a developed state. We assisted the African state in its. Your Excellency, if I may draw attention to paragraph 4 of the compromise, Your Excellency, being a developed state, we assisted in all and every way possible the African state in its to attempt to fight climate change, Your Excellency. Further, Your Excellency, the restructuring.
Talking to you, you assisted them, but
but you have not showed any sign of reducing the carbon emissions.
Your Excellency, if I may draw your attention to paragraph 10, Your Excellency, which refers to the report of the Tom Wood Institute, Your Excellency, and I quote Your Excellency, Rakasha promptly denied these charges, asserting that it had been working for years to lessen its emissions from greenhouse gases with considerable success, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the MCL, if I may draw attention to paragraph. Your Excellencies, the MCL being a private sector construction company, the activities of that cannot be attributed to the state with Articles 4 to 8 of responsibility of states for wrongful acts. There cannot be any attribution. Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, even if there is any issue regarding that, that issue stands settled as the matter was referred to arbitration and compensation was provided to the tune of $35 million, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the agent on behalf of the respondent state humbly says that even if that is assumed as a scenario, Your Excellency, there cannot be any attribution to the respondent state. Your Excellency, as Article 4 to 8, I apologize, Your Excellency, as Article 4 to 8 of responsibility of states for wrongful acts, there with all those provisions, there can be no attribution to our government, Your Excellency. That is only a private entity. And that is already a settled matter as compensation was provided for those damages, Your Excellency. If I may.
Yes, sir.
Any
immunity from seizure of funds?
Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, that is my very next submission. However, if I may just highlight one more factual scenario with respect to the Clean Act.
The question is there any immunity from seizure of funds?
Your Excellency, in the incident case, the international jurisprudence has evolved from the original days of absolute immunity to now what is known as restrictive immunity, Your Excellency. But it is the submission on behalf of the agent of the respondent state that the doctrine of restrictive immunity in the incident case still does not apply and the applicant state
is restrictive immunity.
Your Excellency, the doctrine of absolute immunity has evolved and restrictive.
What is restrictive immunity?
Your Excellency, this concept is
evolved. What is restrictive immunity?
Your Excellency, certain acts of states have in recent jurisprudence have stated.
Yes, what is the
distinction? Yes, much pleasure, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, certain acts of state have been conceived to be acts of that of a private person, similar to that what a private person does, such as giving loans, Your Excellency, entering into any.
What is it exactly?
Yes, sir.
The technical term used.
Yes, Your Excellency. So in those cases, the state cannot claim restrictive
what
immunity.
What is the technical term used for restrictive immunity? Restrictive immunity is extended to
Your
is private acts.
Your Excellency, non-sovereign acts, Your Excellency.
Why are you feeding the bushman?
I
non-sovereign commercial activities.
Yes, Your Excellency.
What is the legislation authority?
Your Excellency, in my submission on immunity,
what is the reason authority of this court?
Your Excellency, that even if that authority exists, it's not with respect to central banks, Your Excellency. Therefore, Your Excellency, it could be distinguished as being applicable in the incident case, Your Excellency.
Last year, the UICK decided a case. Do you have a citation?
Yes, Your Excellency.
Your Excellency,
the agent has not read that case, Your Excellency, but that case is not with respect to central banks.
I just ask you, have you read that case or not? Whether it is relevant or not, it is second question.
Yes, sir.
Your
Excellency, is from agent stands on.
Have you read the Compliance Act in article in American Journal of International Law?
Sorry.
Compliance Act article. Sovereign immunity.
No, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, however, I will put forth various jurisprudence through three slices of Hazel Fox, Zilizong, Yang, Your Excellency, and Honest Blanca, who have dealt with the concept of immunity in great detail.
There is an international document on sovereign immunity pertaining to the problem.
The UN Convention related to jurisdictional immunity, Your Excellency, is that not being enforced as it has not received in our state.
That is also a kind of delay
for an agreement
is not
legislative. Sorry, Your Excellency.
It could be
delayed for an
isolated. It's not
a legislative. Your Excellency, it is not enforced yet, Your Excellency.
That's right. It's not enforced. It's not legislative. It could be delayed for an
isolated. Your Excellency, Hazel Fox in her three crisis clearly stated that the certain provisions of that convention are not evidentially a state practice, Your Excellency.
Is
the
seizure of funds
allowing
the government?
Your Excellency, in the instant case, if I may draw reference to Annexure A of the company, the default clause, Your Excellency, in case of a default, the only requirement of this bond is to provide a 30-day notice, and if that 30-day notice was provided, the judgment attached to the property was committed, Your Excellency.
Assuming that there is a default,
Your Excellency, if then that permitting us to see the assets, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may proceed further, Your Excellency.
Then, if it is a case of breach of contract, the remedy has provided
the
contract itself, saying that
the
remedy is an adequate.
Your Excellency, in the case, the default clause, when read very finely, Your Excellency, clearly states that in case of a default, 30-day notice, in case of lack of payment, the only requirement is seizure, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, there is no dispute in the instant case. It is a mere question of notice being provided, and that notice and that payment obligation was not fulfilled, therefore permitting us to prejudge attach that property, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may proceed further. Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I can draw your attention to page 28 of my written submission, my first submission with respect to that, or with respect to this submission, is that there is no high threshold for central bank immunity, as stated by Mason Fox in our three types, as stated by Zhizong Yang in the three types of state immunity.
If a fund is
lying
with the official organ of the state, can we classify it that the fund will be used only for sovereign function or non-sovereign function?
Much obliged for your question, Your Excellency. So, if I may draw attention to page 25 of my written submission, then I have read this in great detail, Your Excellency.
You argue and refer to the that is the correct answer.
Yes, sir.
You argue and that is reflected in my page number 25 of my
written submission. I am aging on behalf of this one to say, humbly apologize, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, in the instant case, there could be three probabilities. As the opening bank balance of the bank account is not provided. The bank account was existing.
No, it must be very simple.
Yes, sir.
When it is an official organ of the state, whether we can apply the strict immunity or not, yes or no?
Your Excellency, there is jurisprudence to state that when
You answer yes or no and then say, if I ask what is authority, you should, whether you can apply or
not. If that property is for commercial and non-sovereign purposes, yes, Your Excellency.
What about it? Fund is lying with the official organ of the state. Whether strict immunity can be extended to that fund or not?
Your Excellency, immunity cannot be extended in the instant case, Your Excellency. If I may draw attention to footnote 120.
The fund used for that cannot be classified as non-sovereign or sovereign.
Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency.
The presumption is strongly in favor that it is a sovereign.
I apologize, sir.
The presumption is strongly based on the domestic state practice. The presumption is strongly that it is for
Your Excellency, if I may draw attention, there is no restrictive immunity applicable, even if it is a general fund of the central bank property, Your Excellency, they have waived their immunity, Your Excellency. In the default clause, there is an explicit waiver of immunity, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, further.
You also played accusations to that immunity, or the waiver of immunity.
Your Excellency.
When did the loan begin to be claimed? 2002 is it?
Your Excellency, if I may.
When the date came to be claimed?
Your Excellency, if I may reply to the timeline regarding that.
2002 or 2004?
2000, the next loan.
First default was made in?
Your Excellency, the first restructuring was in January 1999. It was restructured again in 2002. Your Excellency,
they have not paid it. As per the loan agreement, within 30 days, you could have reached their approach.
Your Excellency,
for 10 years you kept, whether it amounts to accusation under international, that is the precise question.
Your Excellency,
that point for 10 years, whether that amounts to accusations under international law under the state responsibility. Yes, sir, what is your answer?
Your Excellency, if I may humbly submit that there is a factual inaccuracy in the mind of Your Excellency, that if I correct that.
Whether it was 10 years or 5 years, you have kept quiet for some years.
Your Excellency, the only period that we kept quiet for 3 installments for 3 non-payments, Your Excellency.
Really, it says 30 days default means it is considered as default.
Yes, Your Excellency, if I may draw an attention to paragraph 19.
No notice is necessary.
Sorry, Your Excellency.
No notice is necessary. You can please the court.
Your Excellency, as per the default clause, the failure of the debtor to make schedule.
What about the failure? We are questioning about the clarification of this question. Whether your act amounts to acquiescence in international law.
Your Excellency, if I may first factually correct the. Your Excellency.
What is acquiescence in international law? First, then we go to the facts.
Your Excellency, acquiescence cannot be amounted to in the incident case as.
First, we understand what is acquiescence in international law, then we move on to the case. What is the principle of acquiescence under international law and especially under state responsibility?
Your Excellency is being the doubt in Your Excellency's mind is
well.
With a clarification.
Yes.
Your Excellency.
Have you studied anything on acquiescence under international law?
Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency is the clarification sought by Your Excellency is whether us, the respondent state, remaining silent for the period of non fulfillment of loan obligations amounts to acquiescence and therefore we are stopped from claiming this loan, this seizure of assets.
That is my second question.
Yes, sir.
So, what is acquiescence in international?
Your Excellency, acquiescence in its common terminology would mean whether we are consenting to the non payment of debt obligations by the applicant state.
You have to tell us from the
jurisprudence
of
state responsibility. Your Excellency is moving, even in the case, if estoppel is also termed, even in the case of temple of where we are, is looked at, Your Excellency. There is no acquiescence or estoppel in the incident case, Your Excellency. As the next loan payment obligation was due only on 15 September 2010, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, the loan obligation at Para 19, a grace period was provided, whereas they were given a grace period until 15 September 2010. We served them a notice in February 2012.
What is it under international with reference to reclaiming the payment? Can you cite one example where the lending state has claimed the money back?
Your Excellency, if I...
What is the principle of this peace agreement? That is policy or something like that? The country, there is an alignment, there is an agreement also there.
Your Excellency, if I may cite the schoolish police case, Your Excellency, where long outstanding debt with respect to power, which was originally due to the construction of railways, Your Excellency, since it was used for non-commercial purpose, it was allowed, the seizure was permitted even in that incident case. Even in the case of pretext cooperation, Your Excellency, there is plenty of jurisprudence. Even in the Philippine Embassy Bank case, where the bank account was with respect to a diplomatic mission, Your Excellency, a seizure of assets was permitted, Your Excellency. Your Excellency,
it is damage to self-preservation or self.
Your Excellency, the climate change role in
your long-term measures.
Your Excellency, the climate.
This question was posed to the applicant by my brother, so I'm adding to that. Whether it amounts to countermeasure, self-help, or self-preservation.
Your Excellency, the respondent state is merely exercising a right given to it by the climate change role agreement, Your Excellency. And it is a mere legal permissible exercise of that right, Your Excellency. Much of that, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may move back to what I was stating regarding the probabilities regarding the expenditure of the current $20 million in that bank account. Your Excellency, the outstanding loan amount was $15 million. A grace period was given till 15 September 2010. As of February 2012, there was only $20 million in the bank account. Your Excellency, if I may draw attention to page 30 of my written submission, where I have clearly enunciated that the final use or the ultimate use test has been rejected by international jurisprudence. Therefore, even if the applicant state decides to cite or provides evidence as to the final use of this property being for transplantation or being for sovereign purpose, it would not be applicable and therefore failing even on that ground is permitting the respondent state to attach their property via provision through the climate change zone agreement. Your Excellency, without prejudice to that, the applicant state has expressly waived its right to claim immunity in the incident case. There is pre-judgment attachment to waiver through the default clause. Therefore, the only legal obligation of the respondent state is to provide a notice and within 30 days it may attach that property. And the waiver, being clear and unambiguous, is an explicit waiver and therefore permissible under law. Your Excellency, if I may move to the last submission, being whether the doctrine of necessity can be invoked.
The
yes, sir. Your Excellency, if the default clause is dead, it is clearly stated that the only requirement is a 30-day notice period. Once that notice period is lapses, the respondent state may seize the assets of the applicant state, Your Excellency. That being pre-judgment attachment waiver, Your Excellency. Therefore,
from where the authority got this pre-judgment waiver of immunity?
Your Excellency, if I may draw your attention to page 31.
Yeah, this court is aware of only waiver of immunity, pre-judgment waiver here. Then it will be one-sided loan of immunity.
Your Excellency, a pre-judgment attachment waiver has been cited in recent jurisprudence, Your Excellency.
Which authority?
Sorry, Your Excellency.
Which authority?
Your Excellency, the International Law Commission, when it went to state practice regarding the requirement of waiver for pre-judgment attachment to property.
They have made an observation. They have not made a comment on it.
Your Excellency.
The comment has been made under plain observation.
Yes, Your Excellency.
They read the paragraph. You have the paragraph.
Your Excellency, I have page number, Your Excellency, but I do not have it. Your Excellency, I know at which page it is, but I do not have the relevant page with me right now, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, this is stated at page 41 of that relevant table.
Okay.
Your Excellency, the ILC, when it much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may just summarize my last submission with respect to circumstances precluding wrongfulness and how it cannot be applicable in the incident case. Your Excellency, there could be two arguments regarding circumstances precluding wrongfulness. One would be whether there is a financial necessity. Financial necessity has been rejected by the incident arbitration tribunal with respect to the CMS gas transmission case and the Enron cooperation case, Your Excellency. As financial necessity, the reasoning given by the incident arbitration tribunal was that 100 economists can provide 150 reasons as to how financial necessity. Much of that, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, if I may just state in one sentence, the doctrine of necessity cannot be invoked in the incident case as the interest of the respondent state would.
You don't understand our English? Please conclude.
Your Excellency, if I may state my friend. Much of that, Your
Excellency.
Yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, since the doctrine of necessity involves a cumulative test, if the essential interest of the respondent state would be severely impaired due to non-fulfillment of role obligations, therefore the doctrine of necessity cannot be invoked as one of the criteria is not met, Your Excellency. Much obliged, Your Excellency. If I may state my prayer in the incident case, much obliged. Your Excellency, my prayer is at page 30 of my written submission. My first prayer is that the
applicant. Is there, we can read it.
Much obliged, Your Excellency. Your Excellency is agent on behalf of the respondent.
Thank you, sir.
Three brief points of rebuttal, two on fact, one on law. Your Excellency is on fact, the minority friend stated that they are incurring double the expenditure. They say they are incurring double the expenditure because they are spending the $110 million. Your Excellency is reading the comparable. They are transferring them to site so that they don't spend the $110 million. Indeed, they are not going to spend that $110 million, and that is the first factual rebuttal. On the second factual rebuttal, the respondent accepted by citing the Soaring decision that there must be a serious threat. Next is, I want the court's attention to clarification then when the individual is subject to forced labor, sexual abuse, we submit that is serious. Finally, Your Excellency, is our third submission. The respondent, in response to Your Excellency's question on carbon emissions by the respondent state, they stated that they have been working for years. That was their assertion. If I may draw the court's attention to two paragraphs later, the paragraph they have cited, that uncontested academic studies have noted that their
carbon emissions.
That was the third one. We see it after info. Thank you.
Your Excellency.
At paragraph 37, it clearly states that constructing a new facility would cost $110 million. At paragraph 38, it clearly states that the agreement would also work. The agreement at paragraph 37 provides $110 million would be incurred to build a new detention center, and cost related to transfer would also be met, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, just the other factual inaccuracy being with respect to the unfit test reports an SNC, the respondent state has clearly stated just because another two paragraph statement of conformity does not change the assertion made by the respondent state of SNC. Your excellency, with respect to the soiling test, the risk being of an extreme high eminent nature, the clarification.
You know what is other button?
Sorry,
you know what is other button?
Yes, Your excellency. Your excellency, the agent on behalf of the applicant refers to our submission with respect to the soiling case.
Point out to the facts and then point out to the minute of noting and then you notice.
Your excellency.
You cannot argue anything.
Yeah, yes, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, at clarification 10 itself, where the grievance is mentioned, that grievance has been met, has been rectified by insurance provider. Much of a pleasure.
You and I, the judge and the lawyer, are expected to take part in that process of a voyage to the shores of truth and justice. You ought to have it in you that I am part of an establishment which strives to find out truth and justice. If making money is your only intention, please, there are 101 other jobs which will give you a much, much better return. I want the young lawyers to really understand the significance of being a professional. You have careers, you have professions. Can you tell me what is the distinction between a career and a profession? Career plus something is profession. A mere career is an income earning activity, a life supporting activity. I would refuse to believe that a profession can be equated to a career. A career is one where one earns his livelihood by his work. A profession is something more than a career. I would call it in the modern commercial jargon, career plus. What is that plus? That plus must certainly be the ideal of service to the community around you. A professional, I come across, my experience, I come across quite a lot of people who are wasting their time in this profession because they are mere careerists. You have lawyers to be with them to understand the process, the destination, and the your role, your relevance, your significance in the process that goes on in courts. Well, essentially, the court is a democratic institution. As a judge, I have to ultimately decide. But we are together involved in the process of finding out what is truth and what is justice. The exercise is one of giving one idea, improving the idea by another, and ultimately the person called the judge trying to choosing to decide what is the correct position. Well, all the three, the judge and the two lawyers, are participants in the process of finding out a better idea. The way the lawyer is his ideas. He throws one idea, the other side tries to refute the idea or improve the idea, and that is what the court process is all about. We as Indians pride, what is the greatest achievement that you have made during the last 64 plus 3, 67 years as an independent country, 64 years as a republic. Without batting an eyelid, I would say that democracy has survived in this country is the greatest asset. The greatest achievement of my generation is that democracy was reclaimed. It is available for you to work further on. And what is democracy? Lincoln may have said that it is a government of the people, by the people, for the people. In every examination you write it, but I think it has become an outdated definition. It's only regarding governance that this definition would apply. In the modern Indian Republic, I think democracy is the acceptance of the idea that two heads are better than one. It's the acceptance of the obligation to explain and persuade. In democracy, I can have an idea, but I have the obligation to explain it to you, and and also to persuade you to accept it. And democracy is also the obligation to hear and listen. It is the obligation to improve. It is the obligation always to feel that maybe I am wrong. Maybe I can improve my ideas. And therefore, forget about the Lincolnian definition of democracy. The modern Indian must know certainly that democracy in the modern Indian context is an acceptance that maybe I am wrong. Maybe I can borrow from your idea. Maybe I can further improve my idea. Why? Competitions like this, which give you great opportunity to go forward, they are not merely looked upon as an opportunity to win prizes. I congratulate those who are organizing such competitions, because it weaves into you a program by which you become better lawyers, better democrats also. In that view of the matter, I have the greatest happiness in being part of this function where I'm making the inaugural address of the valedictory function. I wish you all success. May the quality legal education which is intended to be given to you transform you into real professionals.
Honorable Justice R. Asin, the Chief Guest today. Sir Leela Krishnan, Sri Narayan Swami Minister, Professor Jacob Joseph, my guide and guru Professor David Ambrose, all the participants here, and my dear friends, a very good evening to all of you. And also thanks on behalf of Surana, Surana International Economics, and from Nawaz, for making this competition a huge success, I can say that. And I must also thank all the judges who have judged the preliminaries, the semi-finals. I have seen the feedback from you, and I'm encouraged by that. We have taken those inputs from you to improve this competition. Thank you very much for that. And we also express our deep gratitude to Honorable Justice Russell, who is on his way to Delhi. So he is rushing away from here, and I take him that I should get across very quickly. And I also want to tell a few things about the finals. We have such a delectable finals. I was listening to all those arguments, the teams facing a barrage of questions, and you know, all those old things, you know, those concepts of international law, which we have studied long back and forgotten. They were fresh and they were rushing like floods. It was flooding. It was a very pleasant experience. I really thank Dr. Ambrose and the other two judges who put so much questions that the answers, you know, is literally what we call a revision of international law. Thank you very much for that. And then without much ado, I am going ahead with the announcement of the prizes. And now before that, I will request Honorable Registrar to give away the participation certificate to the team in the absence of the Vice Chancellor here. Team number 2, Bangalore Institute of Legal Studies, Sarkip, Shikran and Mevashi. Team number 3, SPKM Ravindra Gandhi College of Law and Sakshi. And Guy Desai. Team number 4, IS Law. Team number 6, Government Law College, Mumbai, Amal Sethi, Krishnendu, Lukash, Shrey. Team number 7, School of Legal Studies, Kochi University. And Jeffrey. Team number 8, Nalsa University of Law, Jagdish, Tarun, Malavika, and Nidhi. Team number 8. Team number 11, Symbiosis Law School, Pune, Himanshu. Team number 12, National Law School of India University, Bangalore, Jain, and Akshay Arad. Team number 13, School of Law, Rice University,
machine in a sense. Team number 14, Kerala Academy and Mission Lab. And finally, team number 15, C.Jessup Law School, Noida, Natasha Bhatia. They are organizers of Asia Long Run and they did an excellent job. And Walls has smashed it. Thank you very much, sir. Team place 4 is team number 3, SVK Pradeep, Sonakshi and I. Thank you very much, sir. Now I request Professor Dr. Leela Krishnan to give a few of the prizes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, sir. Looking at the respondent side. We become eligible for that, and the individual speaker is not for SS Young. Thank you very much. The second best memorial. The best memorial, Akshaya. Now, the biggest of the prizes, the I have a claim to me this year that you will get the international promotion. On the style of the international level, I think they have a. These are the two teams which will represent India in the international rounds. I wish them all the best. Congratulations to the team. And I wish that they get the Indian. Get the international round. After this thing is over, I.
Making this such a successful event.